Hello, everybody.
How are you? Welcome. This is number three.
Yeah. It's cool. We got some new faces on here today, so that's awesome.
I like the pictures that you have showing.
Yeah, I tried to get ones from every area, but I couldn't grab them all, so got what we could, made it work. There's a lot of great pictures up here from the different contests and clinics, and so you can see some of these guys. These are at the 2020 ISA AmpSurf Adaptive Surfing Championships, Parasurfing Championships. And then there's ones from the New York clinics and from the Oregon clinics and a couple other clinics. There's some shots from New England. There's a bunch from a July event last year. So, yeah, a lot of good stuff. You see that they're showing, you know, there's a wave ski. We're going to be talking to Kyle Richardson today about his wave skiing, big wave surfing, and all that good stuff. So, that's a guy, he's just learning his fate from Team Hawaii. And so, yeah, a lot of good stuff. And just, wanted to show people while we're sitting around doing a meet and greet, what we got going on out there and, you know, how we can do it.
I just got back to walk the dog. It's hot.
Anybody see me?
We can see you, Jim.
All right.
Hey, Melissa. Hey, Jacob.
Hey, Melissa.
Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing?
What's up? Jacob. How you doing over there?
I'm doing all right. Doing all right.
Yeah, you're so far away.
You're so far away from me.
Yeah, like around the corner.
Come on, I'm up here.
Literally.
I'm in, right? He hasn't acknowledged.
Hey, Kyle.
Hey. Hi, Kyle. I miss your face.
You. If we don't say hi to you, say hi to us. Because with the screen sharing, we can't see everybody on the screen.
Right. Oh, okay.
We will pop that off in a couple minutes and do a group shot.
There's one from New England.
People who aren't talking should mute themselves. There's a lot of feedback.
Yeah, unless you're talking, go ahead and mute.
Okay.
John, we see you and your team.
All right, I'm here.
Okay,
I'm going to mute you. What up, Bill?
Greg's hiding.
Hey, Marcel. That's okay. Sometimes we don't want people to see the video when we're doing.
You never know what's going on in the background.
That's right. I might be picking my nose. Who knows?
Yeah, I'm driving right now, so I don't think video would really be that interesting.
Yeah, probably not.
Okay, no problem. Depends where you're driving.
Does it turn into a dash cam? Outstanding.
How many? 27 so far. Looking
so
good.
So far, 27. Yeah. Yeah. People, what's this? World's greatest dad. All right. Score one for Dennis. Wait a minute. I thought I was the world's greatest dad. What?
Well, do you have a mug to prove it, Dana?
A girl last year, so this is my very, very, very first Father's Day.
I'm going to show them that I'm the world's greatest dad. Don't worry. I'm not going to talk to him when I answer.
Congratulations on your first Father's Day.
Yeah.
There's your proof, Dana.
I got my award too, Dennis.
Let me find you, my brother.
Hey, Rob.
Oh, there you go. You're all.
Valerie's on. Let me see yours, Dana. Nice going.
Oh.
Hey, y'all.
Oh, there you go.
What's up,
there.
Val? Hey. My guess is we got some good dads on this call all over the place.
Oh, heck yeah.
I think so, too.
Mamas and other ladies.
I thought it was overrated until I became one.
It changes everything.
Yeah, once you do, you can't give it up. It's a forever award.
Brett.
I think I just saw Brett and I was flipping through. There he is. Well, let's see. We still got a few more minutes before we get started with our stretching. It's exciting. We're going to have Ashley Fallon leading us in our stretching today when we get
nice,
to that.
Nice, Ashley.
Sweet. So we've had representation from three of the chapters, I think, out on there for that. That's cool. Spreading it around. Next one, we'll have to get some Oregon folks on there.
Hey, I see Brett Cotter on there. Has anybody said hi to Brett yet?
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, we said hello.
Yeah.
Good to see you guys.
There's
you
a
too,
face with
too.
A name. Good job, Brett.
Val.
Hey Rob.
Mr. Vaca's on, riding his kayak.
Yep.
Well, he gets on these Zoom calls from the strangest places.
Okay. Cool. Can you hear me now?
Joshua.
Yeah, we can hear you, Rob.
We can hear you, Rob.
Okay, thank you.
Pretty good from spring.
So what are we watching?
We're just watching clips from events. Tree. Right now, what's up is from New York last year.
That's Wounded War, that's Warrior Weekend, right?
Yeah, Rockaway Warriors Weekend.
Yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't get there logistically, otherwise I would have snuck over.
I would love to have you. Good job.
I couldn't get from, you know, Manhattan over to that little area you're in.
Well, as they would say in Maine, you just can't get there from here.
No, it's you can't get there from here.
Yeah, I can't get there from here. No, sir.
Yeah.
I have me some lobster. Actually, I'm not in Maine right now. I'm back in California for a week.
Oh, good.
I have to have burritos and tacos and all that other great stuff that's here.
You get tired of the cold?
Yeah. What's that again, Rob?
You got tired of the cold?
Yeah, no, I got tired of the sweltering humidity. It was so funny because there it was 80 something and I was just dripping in sweat. Here yesterday it was close to 100, I think, and it was just fine.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because it's so dry heat here.
No, it definitely is a major difference.
Yeah, no doubt, no doubt. We'll give everybody just a couple more minutes to chime on, then we'll start actually doing the doing our warm up.
Meet and greet.
Stretched out, meet and greet.
Good number, 33.
Chit chat, say hello, and yeah, we've got some good numbers coming in. That's excellent. Excellent.
At first, it only showed one person. I was like, you can't be this bad.
No.
Yeah, no, no.
Now I can see.
I like your background.
All right, so before we have Ashley start, I'm going to switch off the screen share really quick, and we'll do a group shot of everybody that's on. So let me do a stop share. We should see everybody. Outstanding. Or close to everybody. I don't know if I can squeeze. Let me see. I can't get it all onto one page, so I apologize if you are not.
That's good. We have
on this.
Big number.
We'll have to take two pictures.
Yeah. So. Well, I'm in that one, so I can cut myself out. I don't need to be there. Okay. Actually, those ones don't have pictures up, so we want all pictures if we can. Okay, there we go. All right, so hey, everybody, give us a big chaka. Surf. On three to say amp surf. One, two, three, amp surf. Yeah. Woo. All right, we are on virtual clinic number three of the year, and it's awesome to have you guys all here. We've had some phenomenal guests, and we have no difference today. We have more phenomenal guests. Today we actually have four guest speakers, so things are a little bit tightened up, but it's going to be all good stuff. We've got Brett, Kyle, Jacob, and Josh are going to be interviewed today and tell us all sorts of good stuff. But before we start that, we want to have Ashley get us warmed up and ready to go. So, Ashley, we're going to put you on a spotlight, and it's all yours.
Can you guys hear me?
You are large and in charge.
Yes.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ashley. I'm part of the New York City chapter of AmpSurf, and I'm also a certified yoga instructor. So just wanted to take a couple minutes to talk about why you should consider adding yoga into your safety if you don't already, things we can do. Just sitting down at our desk here, from the beach before you paddle out. So yoga and surfing are great complementary activities. Both are thousands of years old, yoga having its roots in India, surfing having its roots in India. And they're both really great for helping us find what's called flow state. And flow state is that feeling that we have when we're riding a wave or doing anything, writing, camping, cooking, where we feel like we're really in the zone. And being in flow state is being in the optimal state of being. It's a way for us to stimulate our parasympathetic nervous system, which research has shown leads to sort of greater focus, more productivity, just greater life satisfaction overall. So the more we can access flow state, surfing or yoga or doing anything else that we love, the happier we'll be overall. So I definitely encourage you, if you don't, there's some great resources out here. I don't know if you can see books on yoga for surfing and other really great tips and tricks for ways you can integrate yoga into your surfing practice. But before we do anything, I always think it's really helpful to start any day or any activity by just resetting our breath. So I'm going to just ask everyone to take some 10 deep breaths with me. So first, just letting all of the air out, and then inhaling for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and exhale for 2, 3, 4, 5. And we'll do that again. Inhaling. And exhaling for 2. One more time. Inhaling for 5. And exhaling. That's 3. Inhaling for 4. And exhaling out. Inhale for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And exhale, 2, 3, 4, 5. And a couple more times like that. And then one more time, inhaling. And exhaling, let that go. And then as we're letting that breath go, just start to gaze gently down toward your lap and slowly start to rotate your neck, waking up that neck, rolling your ear over toward your right shoulder. Here, and then exhale, bring that back through center and then up and over to the left side, rolling the neck out over here. Just bringing your ear about as high as your shoulder, not too high, stretching out that neck gently. And then letting it back through center. And inhale up and over to the right one more time. And exhale, let that go. Come back through center, up and over to the left. And exhale, let that go. And then you can just start to gently roll your neck in your own time. Just moving back and forth, starting to wake up the back of the neck there. And when you make your way back through center, gently lift your head up and take your shoulders with you toward your ears and really scrunch up all that tension, and then roll them down your back. Let that go. One more time like that. We're going to inhale our shoulders all the way up. Really feel it tense, hold tight, and then let go. Roll down the back. Let that tension out. One more time. Inhale, shoulders shrug up toward the ears, and then exhale. There you go. Roll them down your back. And then we're going to do, I don't know if you can see me, a sitting cat cow. So we're going to sit up nice and tall. And then start to arch your back, lift your chest and head up for a cow pose, sitting in our seat. And then exhale, hollow out your belly, roll, round out your back for a cow pose and back through center. Inhale, lift the belly, lift the head and chest for cow. And then exhale, let that go, hollow out, round in the back for cat. Couple more times just like that. That starts to wake up the spine and activate the back chain of the body. And then rounding back out for cat. Couple more times on your own breath. And then we're gonna meet back sitting in a neutral spine. And on an inhale, take your arms out to the side and lift up overhead. And exhale, turn the palms out slowly. Bring your hands down. Awesome, guys. All right. Inhale one more time. Lift it up. Take your spider plant with you if you're me. And then exhale, bring that back out and down. And one more time, lift the arms up overhead. And this time, bring your right arm down to your side. Keep your left arm and just start to gently twist and bend over to the right. And you'll feel that stretch out all along the left side of your body. Take an inhale. And then exhale, come down, both hands by your sides. Gently lift your right arm up this time and over to the left. And inhale. And exhale. On an inhale, and then take your exhale back over toward the center. So now we're going to do a little bit of a twist. So lift both arms up overhead and slowly start to rotate toward your left. Bring your right hand to your left knee and look behind you. And then exhale, bring those arms back overhead. Cross to the other side, left arm comes to right knee, and just gently look behind you, twisting out the spine. And then on an exhale, come back through center. And just gonna stop the, end the session with one little more meditation that I really like, especially for surfers. This is called a conch shell meditation. And what you're gonna do is take your left hand and then take your right fingers and grab your left thumb and just fold your hands together like a conch shell and bring that to your heart. And just like you were listening to ocean waves in a conch shell, just close your eyes and take an inhale. Feel that breath coming in and then exhale. That ocean sounding breath come out one more time. Inhale, just like a wave, and exhale, let it go. And then final time in your conch shell. And then exhale, let that go. And that's it. And I hope that that was fun for everybody and that you'll be incorporating yoga into your surfing practice if you're not already. So thanks, guys.
Thank you, Ashley.
Great job, Ashley.
Ashley, great job. Sorry, I was still muted. I was talking to you. Yeah, thank you so much for doing that for us. I am going to cancel the spotlight on you. And we are going to move to our next speaker here in just a minute. And that's going to be with Brett Cotter, and John Roberts will be interviewing him. So without further ado, why don't you go ahead and take it over, John?
Good morning, everyone, from AmpSurf. Today, my guest is going to be Brett Cotter. Brett's a therapist. He's the author of Three Keys to Managing PTSD. He is the owner and developer of Stress is Gone, and recently joined the AmpSurf Advisory Board. Brett got his education in psychology at the University of Albany. He also minored in criminal justice and anthropology. He's a member of the American Academy of Experts in Traumatic Stress, and he's trained in transcendental meditation. He's also studied at the Himalayan Institute, learning healing techniques, and trained with a healer and Shaolin martial arts grandmaster. Again, Brett, thanks for being here with us. Who are you working with now?
So first, Dana, thank you so much. And John, it's a really honor to be on the call with everybody. So I'm excited to be here with you guys and girls. So I started working with folks in 2000. And initially it was mostly folks that had severe emotional issues. A lot of folks that had really deep-seated childhood trauma. And then in 2004, I had my first client, and that's the real cancer center. And I started working with cancer patients doing meditation classes and things like that. And then in 2006, I had my first corporate client, which was Johnson & Johnson. So that was my first time actually walking into a Fortune 500 company and, you know, teaching stress relief, which was actually my own technique, my own blueprint for stress relief. So since then, if you fast forward to like 2013, 2014, I started seeing like a lot of the VA kind of scandal stuff on the news about veterans that weren't getting, you know, their healthcare needs met. And that kind of infuriated me. I have five veterans in my family. So that hit home. And I had, at that point, I had almost 15 years in the business in stress relief. So I decided to focus on veterans. So I started the nonprofit side of Stress Is Gone, stressisgone.org. And on that website, you could kind of see all the free tools that we have for veterans. You could get the workbook for free. It's a free download there, and our PTSD free mobile app and stuff like that. And ever since then, I've been working with inner city kids, schools, and veterans, right? And partnering with great organizations like AmpSurf. So yeah, that's who I've been working with the last, you know, I'd say 5 years, doing my best to focus on veterans and partnering with different organizations to deliver those, you know, my services.
I'd just like to interject here. Don't be so humble, but you helped the Rockaway community during Hurricane Sandy as well.
Right. That's how we met, actually. That's how John and I connected. And that led to the connection with AmpSurf. So, yeah, so I was volunteering down there after Hurricane Sandy in the warming tent. You know, Hurricane Sandy happened in the winter and it was freezing, and a lot of people in Rockaway lost power. Their houses were flooded. So they were coming to these big warming tents to stay warm and to get food. So I was doing classes down there, and then John, you know, I met John down there, and then me and John put together a program that we delivered for, you know, I was going down to Rockaway every week for a year. And, you know, we had a really nice program. The folks that were coming were getting a lot out of it. A lot of them became testimonials on my website. And that's where me and John started our relationship. Yes, that was awesome.
I know you've also been talking with the hospital special surgery too.
Yes, that's a new development. So I've been reaching out to New York City hospitals since COVID-19, you know, coronavirus has come out. So I'm doing my best to connect with hospitals and offering our services for first responders, you know, the healthcare first responders, the doctors and nurses and folks like that.
Brett, can you give us some background on PTSD?
Sure. So PTSD in its simplest form to me is just our body's way of venting built up emotional trauma, right? That was never processed. So, you know, if I hear a car backfire, right, I just turn my head and look. But when my cousin came home from Iraq, when he heard a car backfire, his shoulders would go up. Sometimes his hand would go up like that. So that stems from the emotional trauma from those triggers, right? That was not processed, okay? So in a nutshell, stress to me is just a reaction to a perception of danger. And it's fueled by fear, and it's perpetuated by worrisome thoughts. Okay, so that's, to me, the simplest, you know, boiling it down to its simplest components is stress. And again, PTSD, to reiterate, is just our body's way of venting built up trauma. Our brain will identify displaced triggers with that example from the car backfiring. So, you know, whether it's a car backfiring or whether it's, you know, if you're in a long line at the supermarket that's not moving, sometimes that'll test your patience and you'll feel the anxiety and the stress build up. Yeah, so that it could be a lot of different triggers. If you get pulled over by an officer, it could be dealing with authority figures. Everyone's different, you know. It could be just on a day that you're, you know, feeling heavy stress, you know, the coronavirus, right? So there are a lot of things going on in our country. If you're watching the news for a prolonged period of time, you might feel your anxiety and stress build up. All that stuff is added to the complexity when PTSD is operating below it, right? Everything else is amplified and intensified. So my approach with PTSD is get to the core memories of trauma. And with the folks that I work with, you know, it's not just combat experience, which is extremely traumatizing, right? But there's usually stuff before one enlisted, childhood traumas and things like that, relationships with parents, or things that actually happen, that we go in and unlock and release the emotions from those memories. And that's really when someone becomes truly free from PTSD and their stress reactions start to reduce in frequency and intensity, okay? And that's when it becomes a lot easier to manage, you know, those reactions.
How's this information useful for our participants, our AmpSurf participants and volunteers?
Well, I think like, you know, what was that cartoon G.I. Joe that would say, you know, knowing's half the battle or something like that. So I think just having the knowledge of what's going on inside your body, becoming aware of it is half the battle, right? And having that knowledge of, okay, this is, my body's just stressed again. Now I want to switch gears and talk about the three keys to managing PTSD, because this is what's really going to help the participants, the instructors, the surfers, is just understanding what the three keys are. And I'm going to go into the first key in depth. So the three keys to managing PTSD is, number one, learn how to stop a stress reaction. Okay. The second key is process the trauma. And the third key is meditate every day. Okay. Now, in the book, the workbook, you could download it for free on stressisgone.org. It's a quick read. It goes through all the practices so that you can master all those keys in a few weeks, okay? But let's just talk about the first key, because learning how to stop a stress reaction, I feel, you know, we all should have learned this in third grade, right? This is really vital information for heart health, for brain health, just, you know, for your relationships, for your everything, for your career, whatever you're doing. If you know how to shut off your stress reaction like that, think about how your life would be different. What would your relationships be like? What would your family life be like if you could just shut down that stress reaction? So learn how to stop a stress reaction. In the workbook, I talk about this technique called stress stopper breath work, okay? And this is really the biggest key, which will help you sidestep stress for the rest of your life. And if you don't take anything else from, you know, our time together today, take away stress stopper breath work. Whenever you're stressed, I want you to touch the tension in your body. For me, it's usually my chest, so I touch there. The second step is start breathing deep and slow. And the third step is, once per breath, silently say the words, "I'm okay," in the back of your mind. So you're breathing, "I'm okay. I'm okay." Let's do three more together. Just do it silently. "I'm okay." Two more. "I'm okay." One more. "I'm okay." All right, so if you did those five breaths with the touch and the mantra, you may have felt your heart rate reduce a little bit. You may have felt a little bit more relaxed. When you're stressed out, I tell folks it takes about 2 minutes for your relaxation response to kick in. Once your relaxation response kicks in after about 2 minutes, your fight or flight reaction shuts off. Okay. So what you feel is the tension actually releases from your body. Your emotions start to balance out, and your thoughts, all those stressful, worrisome thoughts that are driving you crazy, they actually clear out. So that's what I want you to do. Whenever you're stressed out, could be, you know, coming home from a long day. It could be during work. No one needs to know what you're doing. It's done clandestinely, right? So you just touch the tension, breathe deep and slow, and once per breath, silently say, "I'm okay." Do that regularly throughout the day, okay? If you fast forward to the next two keys, process the trauma. Once you get good at that technique, what I do with folks is we surface the traumatic memory, we hold it in mind, and what happens to the body is your heart starts to race. You start to feel the same stress that you felt in that memory. Now we start to use stress stopper breath work to release the tension from the body while you're holding that traumatic memory in mind. Okay, after about 15 minutes, the memory releases all of the tension. And then what happens then, I call it repatterning the memory from stress to rest, okay? So all the panic in the memory leaves. So that when you reflect on that memory and you have no longer stress reactions going on in your body or worrisome thoughts or like guilt or shame or anger, that's when I say that memory is processed, okay? Then if you fast forward to the third key, meditate every day, we just use stress stopper breath work. You shut your eyes, lay down, put one hand on your heart, one hand on your belly button, and you do stress stopper breath work to meditate. Okay, you could use that technique to go to sleep quickly at night if you're having trouble falling asleep. Works awesome for falling asleep, actually. And it's just a natural technique that's free that, again, will help you sidestep your stress reaction, okay? So, yeah. John, anything else you want me to expand upon on that?
Well, yeah. Do you have any tips for parents with children, raising children in difficult circumstances as we're going through stressful situations now, or examples of like how in our lives as water people this can help us?
All right, so we'll start with parents. Since coronavirus kind of kicked in, and I've worked with a lot of parents that have multiple kids, young kids, I feel with the whole homeschooling thing, it's been toughest on kids that were like in third grade and lower. High school kids, it's been pretty easy, you know, seventh, eighth graders, for the most part, that's what I've been hearing. But it's like the younger kids that are just, the parents are going crazy with this stuff. So anyway, the biggest thing when you're feeling that overwhelm is expressing your emotions. So, and this right here is the downfall. I feel not expressing your emotions. And I just want to talk about something really quick with suicide prevention and stuff like that. NYPD, first responders, the suicides there are 12 to 15 a day. You don't hear about that number too much. Not NYPD, I'm just talking about first responders in general across the country. It's like 10 to 15 a day, right? NYPD trends are going up, and that's scary, right? Obviously, we know the 22 per day with veterans. That's also scary. So this is what happens, right? When you don't express yourself and you don't express your emotions and you keep everything down inside, and I think about cops a lot when I think about this, because they don't, they're kind of like really, they keep a lot to themselves, right? Go to the bar to try and vent it out, but everything's kept inside. What happens then is all that tension turns into overwhelm, okay? And when you're not venting it, right, you're not letting it out, that's when you feel the overwhelm, and over time, the thoughts of suicide start to come into mind, okay? And that's a very dangerous place to be. So the quick silver bullet for that is getting really good at expressing your emotions, okay? So what I do when I'm upset, I'll walk in the backyard, or I've gone down to water. Water helps me out a lot. But literally, I'll have it out. Almost like sometimes, almost as if I'm getting into an argument with somebody. Like if you were walking by, you'd be like, that guy's crazy. But I voice my emotions, right? And then I come back to my house, my family, you know, my wife, whatever, myself. And I feel renewed and I could be more authentically myself, right? So going outside, going for a quick walk, even taking your shoes off, feeling the grass, right? Connecting with nature, and then just saying how you feel. You know what? Right now, I really feel pissed off about X, Y, and Z. I feel overwhelmed. I haven't been able to see, you know, my parents. I haven't been able to see my kids, you know, with the whole coronavirus thing. Just voicing it, okay? Giving it a voice. And then once you've given it a voice, you're going to start to feel emotionally raw inside. That's when you touch the tension and do stress drop or breath work for that inner self-care on those emotions and the area where those emotions were just expressed from, okay? That's like a window of self-care that really puts you on a different path, a new path, okay? Which throws the whole alleyway, the dark alleyway of, you know, suicidal thoughts and overwhelm. It makes it so far away once you get good at expressing your emotions and then using stressed out or breath work for the self-care, okay? Now, going forward, moving on to parents. I worked a lot with parents that had children on the autistic spectrum. So kids that were slightly on the spectrum to, you know, had serious issues. What I found with that was the parents' reaction, their stress reaction to their child that was going through an episode was actually feeding the whole episode, the parents' reaction. So what we worked with the parents was calming themselves down. It's kind of like what happens in an airplane when the oxygen masks come down. The parents have to put it on themselves and then they take care of their kids. So when you're working with kids and you have kids and you're feeling overwhelmed, you got to take care of yourself first. So when I was working with those parents, they would sit next to the child that's having an episode and they would calm themselves down. Once the parent was calm, then they would put their hand on the child's knee and then just start breathing. And there would be an exchange of energy where the child in about 2 to 3 minutes would understand what's going on, they would look into their parents' eyes, and they would start to just calm down naturally. So it wasn't like the parents were saying anything, it was just more of a subconscious conveying of calmness, that the child's body would absorb. Okay. So now if you move forward now to being in the water, I feel like water is such an amazing thing, except especially for like surfing and amp surfers and stuff and the instructors, because when you're in the water, your mind focuses on the moment, right? So that's why the water I feel is so calming for many people. Your mind focuses on the moment because all of your faculties have to focus on keeping your head above water. So you're paying attention to waves. You know, you're really, your perception dials into the moment. You're not thinking about the past or the future. You know, your worries kind of go away for the most part. Then you might have a first time surfer who, you know, has the board hit them, gets caught up in some white water, takes in water. Now they might have a survival reaction, a PTSD reaction. So what I feel there is every time you're working with a first time surfer, going through stressed opera breath work and telling them, look, before you get in the water, I just want you to know what's going to happen. You're going to fall off the board. You're going to be washed up in some white water. It's going to feel a little scary for a second. I'm right there for you. I have you. And you're probably going to take some water in, right? What I want you to remember is the technique. We're going to do it right now. You're going to start breathing deep and slow. If you can, you could just touch wherever you feel tense. If you can't, just hold on to the board. Breathe deep and slow. Silently, I want you to say, I'm okay, once per breath. When you're in the water with them and they fall off the board, you're going to help them and you're going to remember our breath. I'm okay. So you're going to model breathing deep and slow. You're going to model the technique so it transfers them. And they go, oh yeah, I'm going to start breathing deep and slow. So their stress reaction releases from their body and they're back onto the next wave. So John, I believe, had an interesting story. He called me a few months ago and told me about. So John, if you could share a quick version of that story.
Hey, Brett and John, make it quick. Then we gotta move on to Q&A.
I know. Wait, we're running out of time here. Yes. Just my quick example. I was out, stand up paddling out in the ocean, and the wind all of a sudden kicked up about 25 knots, 3 or 4 foot seas from the north northwest, and I'm going right into it. I'm getting smashed all over the place, and I can't even turn the board around. So I remembered the three keys. Of course, I couldn't put my hand on my heart because I was hanging on to the board and the paddle. But what I did is I started out paddling on prone, got up to my knees, finally got up standing up, and every stroke was breath, exhale, I'm okay. And eventually, about the half hour later, I was about 2 miles off home base. I made it back. So there's a practical example. So Brett, I'd like to thank you very, very much. From the AmpSurf community, you're a great asset, not only to our advisory board, but to everybody you work with. Thanks so much.
Thanks for having me, guys. Really appreciate it.
Awesome, Brad. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Hey, so we're going to do a quick Q&A. So if anyone wants to ask Brett a question, I'll start off with one from the chat from Lonnie. Basically, her question, Brett, is, you know, what's your biggest advice for someone finding programs to address non-combat related PTSD who don't have networks and community resources like the VA? So where can someone reach out in the community to get this type of help? If, you know, if they're not in your area or somewhere, you know?
Yeah. So I would say a lot of things work for different people, right? So like one thing might work for somebody, one thing might work for somebody else. So I would identify, like, put like 5 to 10 things on your hit list, like yoga, meditation, group work, individual counseling, some apps, things like that. And then just go down it, just like a hit list. Start trying stuff. And then I would be more than happy. I do free, one-on-one coaching sessions with veterans. And then my first one for any civilian is free as well. So what that does, it takes the edge off and it gives you like a really good taste of what the process is so that you could use it on your own. Like my whole program is about to empower anyone that comes close to it with the tools. So I encourage you to go to stressisgone.org, download the PTSD free app. You can schedule a free session with me. And then I have the meditations every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 9 a.m. Eastern on Ring Central Meetings. All you gotta do is download Ring Central Meetings app. And the meeting ID is 582-811-3947, okay? And then it's a meditation and we go into any stress reactions, triggers. We go into all that stuff. We go in through the brain, and we go down the throat, the chest, and deep into the heart. So we're actually going deep into the heart to help folks let go of the old emotional blocks that they have that are coming up in everyday life that, you know, intensify our stress reactions. So yeah, it helps release the tension from those old memories as well. And I encourage you to download the workbook for free on the stressisgone.org website. Once you read that workbook, and again, it's a quick read, you're going to be far ahead of anybody else that hasn't read that book in regards to managing stress. I was doing a class for about 2 years in a medical facility that had severe psychiatric patients in it. I mean, like schizophrenia, multiple personality disorder, really severe things. Within a few months, their stress was lower than the doctors and nurses, and they could handle their stress better than doctors and nurses were handling their stress. When I first started the class, their stress was at a 10 out of 10. And after about 2 months, the average stress was between 2 and 3. So, you know, use these tools. I encourage you to use these tools and then try a lot of different things. You might find stuff that, you know, really works for you.
Well, hey, Brett, thanks so much. We're pretty much out of time. There are a few more questions on the chat. So you can see those, and if you could just answer those via the chat, that would be great. Again, thank you so much for everything you're doing. Thank you for joining our advisory board. We are so stoked to have you, and because a lot of our clients do have PTSD, and speaking from myself and my PTSD, I've done your workbook. I appreciate and I implement your tools on a daily basis, so thank you so much. We're going to take the spotlight off here, and we're going to transition to our next speaker and interview E, and that's going to be Randy Woodrow is going to interview Kyle Richardson, and he's a big wave surfer, so I'm going to spotlight Kyle. And Randy, why don't you go ahead and take it over?
Okay. Hi, good morning. Can you all hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes. We can hear you. We're all on mute.
Yep. Nice to see you. Nice to meet you. Okay. Kyle joins us this morning, I believe, from the Seattle, Washington area. Kyle was born in Phoenix, Arizona, and grew up an avid skier, surfer, windsurfer, motorcycle rider, and golfer before his T7-T8 spinal cord injury. Kyle has lived and traveled to over 35 countries over his years, growing up as a military brat, and made a living as a commercial automotive photographer in the automotive industry before being injured and becoming wheelchair bound. Kyle first sustained sudden hearing loss, a debilitating consequence from the exposure and impact of bacteria from the water while surfing. The bacteria reaction to the medication caused loss of core strength.
Oh, good. So you got a smaller box you can mail back your other ones in.
Organ degradation and hampered his ability to breathe. After years of being treated and bedridden, Kyle slowly started to recover and come back from weighing only 90 pounds. Several surgeries and implants later, including a cervical and spinal stimulator, Kyle made his way back to the water after relearning daily functions and to swim again. 8 years later, Kyle's back surfing and big wave surfing, along with a variety of water sports and adventures, while creating media for various clients and sponsors. Kyle works with Island Beach Access on Whidbey Island to make the Pacific Northwest more inclusive, not just for wheelchair users, but for various residents of the state of Washington. He continues to surf for fun and competition. His biggest goal is to continue developing and fundraising a program for adaptive big wave surfing out of the Pacific Northwest and North Shore Oahu, with several big wave mentors, including Derek Dorner, Ricardo Tavera. So Kyle, very impressive stuff. I'm a physical therapist at the VA. Can you share with us a little bit more about your rehab and recovery and how you were able to get back to where you are today?
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if everyone can hear me, but thanks for having me, and really an honor to be here and kind of answer the questions, and hope I can give everyone some insight that they're looking for. Basically, when I was first kind of on my path to recovery, I was moved up here to the state of Washington, and I live on an island a little bit where we don't have resources to major hospital systems with a lot of rehab. So I had to kind of spend most of my time either in Seattle in the hospital, or when I was here on the island, I was lucky enough to have a group called Rehab Without Walls. And I had about five physical therapists, occupational therapists, and also like mental health and stuff like that, working with me in and out the house every single day for about 9 weeks. That was pretty much priceless to have it in your home every day. You know, five people coming to your house 7 days a week is pretty special. So between that, aqua therapy, and really probably my friends and family not willing to give up on me, even at times when I was kind of, you know, down or, you know, wanting to be a little discouraged, everyone around me kind of helped keep me glued together and pull through.
Okay, you surf on a wave ski. Can you tell us what a wave ski is and how it's different or how it's the same from a standard surfboard?
Sure. Yeah. So wave ski was originally invented in Peru about 3,000 years ago, right around the time that surfing was invented, actually, kind of coexisted side by side. In Peru, they first started to use them as like fishing vessels, and they were made of straw, like hay. From there, in like kind of the 1980s, we kind of had this big, huge boom, and wave ski was actually super popular and was actually on charts to be the first kind of water sport before surfing in the Olympics. Fortunately, it kind of lost a little bit of momentum there in the late 90s and ended up not going in. Basically, they call it the Horses of Totoro is what originally was named. Because it's basically a sit-down surfboard, you can see in the picture, there's two wave skis that are on the screen here. You basically have foot straps and you have a seat belt, and different people use straps for their paddle or no strap, but you're basically strapped into this board and you basically sit down surfing almost like a kayak position, except it's on a board that's real lightweight like a surfboard.
Okay. You've been to a lot of countries. Can you tell us, this is a trick question, what's your favorite surf spot and why?
Gotcha. Yeah, that would be a pretty tough question as far as, you know, favorite surf spots, but really probably anywhere, you know, you can, you know, get your stoke on or really just have time in the water, have time with friends, really experience the healing nature of, you know, the animals in the water with you, your friends, just being out there in nature is pretty powerful. As far as like waves and stuff like that goes, I've never been to Australia. That's on my like bucket list to go do some slabs over there and Western Oz and New Zealand maybe. But right now I think my heart's, you know, more in North Shore Oahu and also in Fiji. I'm really passionate about the area over there. So yeah, I'd say both of those areas are pretty incredible.
That's great. Okay. What do you think surfing does for you physically, mentally, overall? And how do you see it helping others as a form of therapy?
Yeah. I guess the one thing would be like, what doesn't it do? You know, it's endless endorphins that naturally are just like rushing your body. And, you know, for me, it just totally takes away any stress that I've had for the day, for the week, for the month, for the year. And you really just kind of, for that moment when you're out there, your disability, everything kind of goes away and you're just another person in the water. And most of the time you're treated that way too by fellow surfers and things like this. And because of that camaraderie, whether it's wave ski, surfing, it's just really a healing process, I think, for anyone, because we're all just trying to be in nature and just trying to experience the best we can our time out there. So.
Absolutely. Awesome. Oh, okay. Kyle, please share with us how you first got connected with AmpSurf.
So I think that would be Dana. Dana, I saw him in the parking lot at a surf event. I totally embarrassed myself at by putting the wrong fins in my board. But I met him at Salt Creek maybe about a year and a half or 2 years ago, I think. And yeah, ever since we've kind of surfed a bunch there when I'm taking camping trips down. I have a Euro van that has solar and kind of retrofitted, and I go down the coast a lot and spend 2 to 8 weeks on the road at a time or and just go and surf. So I tend to see him when I'm down there in California.
Oh, nice. It's cold up in the Pacific Northwest. I assume you need to wear a wetsuit up there. What do you look for when choosing a wetsuit, and what modifications do you make to your wetsuits?
Yeah, good questions. Definitely here you need wetsuit. I would probably urge against using a rash guard other than maybe Dana. He's crazy enough to just go rash guard and board shorts. But it's definitely like in the summer right now, or, you know, maybe in another month, we're going to be in the 3-2 kind of wetsuit weather. If you're pretty warm blooded, if you're, you know, get cold easy, you'll want to be in a 4-5 right now. And that would be like newer wetsuits that are pretty warm. But the water, I want to say, is about like 46 degrees right now. You're on the island. So a little chilly.
Do you have any specific modifications to your type of wetsuits that you use?
Yeah. So some of the things that I've done in the past have been putting zips into the arms, so it's easier to get your arms in and out, or putting zips into like a jacket chest piece. Kind of at the start, I would wear more two-piece wetsuits. Now the material's getting more stretchy. The newer wetsuits you're able to actually get into as a para without as much, you know, challenges as it used to be. Some people use plastic bags on their feet, whether you're, you know, disabled or not. That helps get your feet into the lower legs, or you can put, again, zips in the legs. And I can take pictures and show somebody various wetsuits if they have questions afterwards. I have quite a few different ones that I've had made over the years.
Absolutely. I've seen people adding zips over the years. And the question that I've never asked that I've always wanted to know is, does adding a zip at all compromise the integrity of the material wetsuit?
Gotcha. It's not going to, if it's done right, it shouldn't, you know, compromise the material of the wetsuit. What it would compromise would be more allowing water to get through that that zipper. A little bit of water will get through. And since you're not going to have the wetsuit material fully there, you will have kind of cold seams in those areas. But that's about it.
Oh, great. Got it. Thanks. Thanks for telling me that. Okay. Please share with us why you started chasing giant waves and how you want to get more adaptive surfers out riding them.
I don't know. Maybe screw loose, possibly. I think it was just natural. My whole life I've kind of been, chasing wind, chasing waves, just chasing adrenaline, whether it's been on, you know, motorcycles, race cars, anything to kind of go bigger and faster and a little more extreme, no matter what it's kind of been in my life. Kind of as I've been getting back here into surfing and able to surf more here in Washington in the winter when the waves are bigger, it just was kind of a natural progression. And I've always kind of done a little bit better in the larger waves than smaller waves. So just seemed like next steps, and it's been really rewarding.
What do you attribute that to, doing better on the larger waves than the smaller waves?
Yeah, I don't know if it comes from, for a while I was really big into mountain sports and, you know, did cat skiing to, you know, backcountry skiing and a lot of, you know, larger mountain stuff. And I don't know if it's, you know, time from being on the mountain, and it's almost similar to, you know, surfing big waves. It's a very different style of surfing than surfing smaller waves or faster type pieces. So I think it's just natural progression.
Awesome. Great. So our lesson today is about not being a kook. What is something you see people do in the water or at the beach that would make you say, what a kook? And remember, don't be too hard on Dana.
I don't know. I'm pretty sure the picture of me up here with the reindeer on the front of me and a Santa Claus hat is pretty priceless there to be a kook. Everyone says that whole concept of being a kook, and I think probably that's one of the best things about being surfing, right, is that we all are kooks in moments, and we all do silly things when we go out there, and we're just living in the moment, and we're super excited. You know, I've put on wetsuits improperly, you know, put on a wetsuit backwards to whatever, you know, you're just so excited to be there, you throw on your stuff and you run out, and before you know it, you realize, oh, wow, I just put on my wetsuit backwards at 5 a.m. So I think just maybe embrace your inner kook would be the better advice of my own. But be respectful, I guess, at the same time to everyone around you. You know, I think that's probably the most important thing I would say of surfing is, if you want to have fun and go out there, that's the best part. But keeping in mind everyone around you and the relationships that, you know, kind of you'll build over those years. If you go to the same surf spots, you're going to see the same people there day in and day out. And so I just think it's really important that we're really respectful to our own local spots, but also to spots when we were traveling, and definitely really put the locals first and, you know, include them to have a good time, but be respectful at the same time.
So. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for sharing your story and your insights and your inspiration with us and being part of this AmpSurf virtual adaptive surf therapy clinic. We appreciate it.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hey, Kyle, thanks so much. Hey, so we're going to turn it over for Q&A. So anyone has a question for Kyle, everyone else, just give each person a chance to speak, and then Kyle will speak. And then, Kyle, we've got some questions on the chat we'll hit as well. So anyone's got a quick question for Kyle, go ahead.
Yeah, I do.
Kyle, John from New York, Rockaway Beach. When I was in Australia back in the early 70s, I learned to surf ski on those big wooden boards the lifesavers used, and then I got a foam board. I'm just curious as to how you handle a wipeout on a large wave. You know, are you locked in real hard with your straps that you couldn't get out if you needed to?
It's pretty violent, yeah. It's the big wave wipeouts are really harsh. It's a lot harder on a wave ski than it is on a surfboard. We're seatbelted in, and you wanna stay in that seatbelt on that wipeout. Because if you were to try and get out, even if you were, you know, being thrown over the falls, you're not going to have enough time to get your legs out of the straps and away from the board. And so if you took the seatbelt off, you'd have a good chance at, you know, snapping both your legs in half or something like that. So you do have a lot of impact on your spine when you do go over the falls or something like that. So that's been the biggest challenge with the big wave surfing, is going up in size, but without, hurting or killing yourself.
do you have to work on, I know you work on your training, but do you do a lot of breathing exercises because you're getting held down and ragdolled?
Yeah, so I've been doing breath training for about the last 4 years. Been doing some in like colder aqua, you know, ice pools, to then warmer weather stuff in Hawaii. I have about a 4 minute and 45 second static apnea hold, so I can hold my breath, you know, about that long. On dry land or in water with no energy being used. But when, you know, you're being tumbled in big waves, you definitely have a much shorter breath hold. Breath hold is extremely important, along with the right safety gear and a team. You know, I would stress that big wave surfing is not just a one person event, unless you're, you know, very select few surfers that have been doing that, you know, and started maybe the big wave stuff, but it's very much a team sport, especially when you're talking, being towed into waves and things like that.
Keep it up. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Hey, Kyle, do you surf in Whidbey only, or do you also go down to Ocean Shores?
Yeah, so I surf kind of all over here in Washington. Right now, a lot's closed, so I'm not able to do too much right now. I surf Westport, La Push, the Straits, and then all the way down into Oregon. So
every time I've been out there, it seems like it's pretty much walled up down on Ocean Shores and LaPorte. Is it always like that, or does it kind of break up?
Yeah, definitely not always. Kind of depends on time of year. I don't know what time of year you were going and stuff like that. February, March, kind of June, July are pretty good times there at La Push, you know, that it's 6 to 8 foot beach break most of the times.
Yeah. Cool. Thanks.
Yeah.
Anybody else got a question for Josh? We have him. Josh, I've got a quick question. One of the earlier photos, it showed a larger board and a small, well, I shouldn't say a larger board and a smaller board, but a longer board and a shorter board.
Yeah.
Could you just tell me and tell the rest of the group why the two different sizes and what types of waves you ride with those two different styles?
Yeah. The, you know, wave ski is just like a surfboard where you have various, you know, size lengths to widths to even shapes. You know, they do the same thing, fish style designs to pintails to, you know, more short boards to, you know, more longboard style cruisers. In that picture were the two whiteboards. One was kind of like my shorter, I surf for Salamanzi, who's a manufacturer. And those were kind of my two boards last year for my quiver for competing last year. One was the taller one that I use for surfing big waves. I paddle on it. And then I also do tow in on it. So it's specially built where it has, you know, plates for adding weights and stuff like that. When you get towed into waves, you know, it's made stronger. We actually learned a lot last winter with that board and already have the next one we're working on. Actually a couple of them, different weights and lengths and stuff like that. There's a picture I think I sent you, and it shows the board really skipping out of the water. And on the big wave stuff, you're going so fast, you know, 30 to 40 miles an hour, even in some of these waves, that, you know, the whole board was totally getting out the water where you could see clearly under the fins, everything. So pretty scary if you grab a rail or something like that going 38 miles an hour with a 40-foot wave behind you. So,
yeah.
So we've just been, you know, continue to do R&D because none of this has been done to this size on kayak or wave ski ever. So it looked, you know, this winter, that one wave of the picture, it looked like it was, you know, 38 to 43 feet, that wave. And so they're still figuring out if it's the largest ever been done on the kayak, but yeah.
Was that the one, the main picture that we had up?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is just a sick,
very impressive.
Yeah. <Here. laughs> I have one more question, and I don't want to hog you, but so I know you're doing the big wave stuff over in Hawaii when you go there and stuff. Have you been doing any up in the Northwest, like at Nell Scott or any of the other locations up there? Because those, I mean, we did it in January and it was pretty intense and pretty heavy and cold and like just insane up there.
Yeah. Nell Scott's fun. I like Nell Scott. I surfed there before even injured, and that was pretty neat. It's definitely a really different wave, and it changes all the time through the weather, which is pretty cool. So yeah, I've done, you know, Lincoln City all over down there for big wave stuff in the winter. And then I've done some up here. But yeah, I'd say most is starting to be more now in North Shore, Oahu. And then this next winter, I'll be going over there a fair amount, and then to Maui also.
Cool. Cool. Okay. Anybody else got a last question for Kyle? I think we got all the ones answered off the chat.
Cool.
All right. Well, hey, Kyle, thank you so much for being here with us today and sharing your knowledge of the big wave surf and the wave ski stuff. A lot of us aren't, you know, I've started to wave ski, but not big into it yet. And a lot of us aren't. So it's really good to hear that information and learn about it from you and everything. And I know a lot of our adaptive surfers that are also dealing with different types of paralysis and other conditions can really benefit from this. And so we'll have this recorded and everything and be able to share that with others as well that aren't on this call. So thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, no, I really appreciate it. And hey, Dana, I just would like to say one last quick thing. And that's, anyone hasn't seen wave ski, it's almost like a combination of bodyboarding and surfing. Some of the aerials are out of this world extreme. If you've never seen it, any of the Salamanzi guys or Pablo Airways, some of these guys online are definitely worth checking out. It's pretty amazing.
Set the standard, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome, Kyle. Thank you. I got a question on the chat, but it's more just for an AmpSurf question. But yes, we do have some questions. Does AmpSurf have wave skis? We do have some here in California. I don't know if we have any at our other chapters, but we would like to get some more and get them spread out around the different chapters and stuff. We did some training at the last clinic, the last live clinic we had in March down in San Diego. And it was a huge success with some beginning wave skiers. And this one gal was just, you'd think she was born on the thing. She was just ripping it up. It was so amazing. So yeah, it's something we definitely do want to offer more at our chapters and around the country and get more folks into it. It's a really neat and fun way to ride waves. What little I've done, I've enjoyed. My only thing for me is I lost the first wave I caught on a wave ski. I lost one of my legs and never got it back. So he's very right about not unstrapping, because it will try to rip your legs off. If your feet are in the stirrups and your body's not, yeah, it's not a good combination at all.
Neil Stevenson, he created what's called the Neil flip, and he was an amputee, and he does a backflip, this kind of reverse backflip on the wave ski. And he's,
oh, wow.
yeah, and so it's very possible to do insane things on them, which is really cool.
Yeah, I know that one guy from Brazil. I can't think of his name, but he's just it's just amazing to watch what he does on that wave ski and the way he, you know, just charges waves and, you know, does cutbacks and hits the lip and everything else. It's nuts.
Yeah. Cool.
Kyle, again, thank you so much. We're going to transition over to our next speaker. So, and we're going to have our AmpSurf instructor, Dennis, is going to interview Josh Bogle from Hawaii. And so let me just change this over really quick. And Dennis, why don't you go ahead and take over for us?
Hey, hello and aloha, everybody.
You can interview Mr. Josh. Thank you.
You betcha. Hey, what an honor and a pleasure to be here with everybody in this AmpSurf family and interview Josh from Maui, Hawaii, from Haiku, the town. He is a quad amputee. Josh caught strep in 2011, which he recovered from, but left him with a heart condition. In early 2012, he accidentally stepped on a fish hook and caused another severe infection called DIC, bacterial infection. All this led to the lack of blood flow to Josh's extremity, which caused him to lose portions of his arms and legs. And after suffering through this, surviving the pain on pain meds and unable to get around effectively for years, Josh discovered adaptive surfing in 2017, and it has transformed his life. I know you're putting up some impressive numbers and being a part of this the competitive adaptive world contest. You put up some impressive numbers. You placed second in the Hohoku Kipa in 2018. Haleiwa placed third place in 2019, fifth at the Open Wells, fifth at the Bali Adaptive Pro, and third at the Sunset Beach Oahu Open, second at Lahaina Breakwell. Josh surfed with the Team Hawaii and also competed at the 2020 AmpSurf ISA World Parasurf Championship. And it was awesome actually meeting you, Josh, your team, and watching impressively how you guys really did well down in San Diego. So, Josh, thank you again for joining us and being a part of the call. Tell us, how does it feel to represent Team Hawaii and Hawaii being a birthplace of surfing? And I know it's pretty big and a big responsibility because quite literally, everybody that goes to Hawaii pretty much knows they're under the gun, you know, of many eyes. So how does that responsibility live up and how do you live up to that?
Oh, thanks, Dennis. Aloha. And yeah, appreciate you guys giving me the opportunity to be here this morning and speak to the passions of surfing that wake me up each morning between the roosters crowing and the waves breaking here in Hawaii. I feel like every day is a real blessing to be able to partake and enjoy this sport, especially here in Hawaii. And so it's for me, it's become a blessing to carry the flag and go to some of these countries and represent Hawaii.
You're doing a great job too. So answer me too, Josh. What kind of board do you ride, you know, and actually pretty much setting the standards for many around the world? What would you recommend for surfers with the same condition or pretty close to as far as picking a board and to make it fun for them to actually get to where you're at or even not even close, but just to enjoy it more?
Yeah, I started on an 8-foot board. It was a little thicker. I think it was 3 inches thick in volume. But that extra volume helped me not having hands and being in surfing shape to paddle into waves. I think a little thicker volume board, and you can right. play with a shorter length too. It really helps you get into the wave so you're not exerting so much of your energy on the paddle in, and you can really just focus on catching the wave and performing on the wave.
I think that's definitely important for any of us paddling into waves to do it more effectively and efficiently. So how do you feel adaptive surfing changes the lives of those living with lifelong conditions? I know it's changed you, and we in AmpSurf family have seen many lives changed. And how do those that haven't experienced, how would you explain or how do you think it changes those lives in your life?
I'm fortunate here. Hawaii's adaptive sports program has been growing leaps and bounds to participate and get people in the water for their first time ever. And seeing the changes in their life, even if it's just going out for a half hour and having a catcher and a pusher and people in the water with them, just let them know they're okay. And that feeling of when somebody's laying prone on a board for their first waves that they've caught, it really just kind of changes them. And I think the ocean's really good at stripping off our PTSD or our emotional stuff. And it really just kind of brings us into that flow state of life.
I totally agree. I mean, we at AmpSurf, I mean, we really look forward to seeing the release of these people, first time surfers, just doing what you just explained, you know, just releasing and forgetting for just that 1 second, you know, or those moments of what's been going on in this world and then just living in that moment. So it looks like you've surfed some really cool places in this world, and I know you have, you know, and it's hard choices, but what's your favorite spot for what you like doing? And I know you probably like doing different styles of surfing, from surfing big to maybe trying, you know, try trick waves. So what's your favorite surf spot and why?
Hokipa here, right? It's kind of my neighborhood break, a couple miles from the house. It's on the North Shore. But we're really blessed in the summer with some wraparound summer swell from the east swell, from the trade winds. So I actually yesterday went out with both my prosthetic legs with these new wilder liners and tried surfing with prosthetic legs for the first time ever.
How'd that work?
I got a left and a right where I was actually standing on the wave.
Yay, right on. Yeah. New stoke, I love it.
Totally.
All right.
But Hokipa challenges.
Yeah, go ahead.
I've been there when it was 8 to 12 foot faces and really had to find that center in my breathing, because I could keep paddling farther out to escape the outside sets coming in. But at some point I knew I needed to get my breathing in check and catch some of these waves back in. So
what did you do? I mean, to get your breathing in check, what kind of advice would you have, you know, for somebody that might not have experienced what you're feeling at that moment yet? What did you do to get your head straight, get your breathing right?
I do triangle breathing. It's a 3 second inhale, a 3 second exhale, and then I'll hold for 3 seconds. So kind of imitating, you know, going down on a wave and you're holding your breath.
Excellent.
When your heart rate's up, just getting that practice of, okay, I want to bring in as much air as I can, release as much as I can, and then hold. And then I'll reverse it. I'll do the same technique where I'm exhaling for 3 seconds, and then I'll inhale for 3 seconds, and I'll hold with full oxygen instead of release of oxygen. And it's a great way to just reoxygenate the blood and move the CO2 out.
And then get that calm feeling, so when you're on the outside, you're just tearing it up. I love it.
Yeah.
So what do you think is special about surfing? I know you've been touching on it and other surfers in these interviews. What do you think makes it special, the activities for those living with physical, mental, cognitive, and other types of condition?
Oh, I think the ocean really, for me, there's a real blessing that I've started to practice, and I really feel like it gives so much life to the planet, but also to any person willing to just come and be there. Even if you're not in the water and you haven't crossed that fear barrier yet to get on a surfboard and go out in the waves, even just sitting there and letting that salt spray air kind of be by your face and just breathing, it really just kind of lets you go back into this. Hey, everything's okay. Yeah. You know, everything here in this moment is here for you, and it's been here for ages, and we're just lucky to be on this planet and be gifted with such an amazing abundance. So
also too, when you're training for like bigger waves, is the training any different? Is there any type of adjustments to, you know, to your stereotypical big wave training? Is there any adjustments that
you had to do to, and help with others, obviously, to get ready to get ready to get punished by these bigger waves. I've also seen you do some are on your videos. You have some pretty good, cool videos of kite skiing. Have you, and for surfing, have you ever tried finless surfing where you're pretty much like knee dropping, doing insane things like that?
Just recently, just this spring, practicing is, both finless and, a shorter board, almost the length of a boogie board.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome.
Just to actually center the center of gravity on it and practice those 360s and spins. And but with the big wave surfing, to go back to your first question.
Right.
I'm really fortunate, just up the road, some really world-class athletes for maintaining the level of wave riding they do. There's a little gym that they work out at. We're happy to share their activation and workout techniques and then let me adapt with my disability how I could do those. There was this amazing gift of working out with them and seeing the level of training they were putting in to going out and do these waves.
What would you say to other surfers that don't have the access that you have up and down the East and West Coast that have inspiration to hit bigger waves but don't have the access to trainers like you do? What can they do with the things they have around the house, with possibly friends and things to get them ready for bigger waves? Is there any advice you have for them?
Oh, yeah. Even just 5 minutes a couple times a week, if you can grow that up to 15 minutes, 3 or 4 times a week. And it's really good to start with some yoga or restorative moving just to get the body loose.
Oh, very good.
And you can use, I've used everything from a hydro flask full of water to books to a box of quinoa that I got from Costco during quarantine to just add 2 pounds of weight and just practice lifting, just kind of opening the shoulders up. And if you're in a wheelchair or you're on the ground, you can just do it just sitting. And it's just a great way to just open the side bodies up and shoulders. So when you're out there paddling, you're actually not taking your body backwards, but your body's engaged and ready to go out and go have fun.
That's awesome, brother. Thank you so much. Let me see. If there's anybody out there that has any questions, because I can ask this guy a bunch of questions. I love Maui. I love the island surfing out there, but there's nothing better than just the power of knowledge and having people like you and all our other speakers with this knowledge. I think sharing it is probably the best thing in the world, because even though most of us might be aware of it, it's also great to have, you know, that little enforcement from those that are actually doing it every week, day in and day out. What an inspiration. And like I said, I loved watching you guys. Your team did freaking awesome in San Diego. Congratulations. It was awesome meeting you and your team. I loved it. I loved everything you guys did out there and everybody else, of course. But since I'm interviewing you, brother.
Oh, yeah. No, I that's before the question answered, let me just throw that out to people.
Yes.
The biggest challenge in my life was learning how to ask, whether just the most simplest thing, or I had a lot of unresolved past stuff in my life. And the more I just got comfortable asking other people, that's where the real release in life happened, where that
is great.
Got passed on. And so if you're just holding back a little bit, but you want to ask a question, just go for it. You'll be amazed at the response the world will give if you're open to it.
And I love that advice. You know, there's great advice, but that is big key. So don't go away. I mean, I know we have people with some questions.
Cool.
That I'm sure you would enjoy answering. So if there's anybody out there, feel free to answer, ask some questions. Thank you, Josh. You're the best, brother.
I don't know.
Thanks, Josh. If anybody's got questions, by all means, fire away at Josh. We've got about 5 more minutes. Josh, I just have a quick question on the board that you ride. It looks like from a lot of the pictures, they're like a pretty standard long boards. And I know I see guys that you compete with also using the knee boards that have the special pads. And I think of guys like Mono, who has like a big thing carved out of his board. Do you have any adaptions like that, or are you using pretty standard boards?
I hadn't done any dugouts yet on a knee board style board. I was still just riding longboard only. And this summer I'm playing around with that shorter, high volume. But I'm actually learning knee boarding on those shorter knee boards fresh. I learned how to surf on a traditional longboard.
Yeah. Very cool. Very cool. Other questions, guys? I can bug them all day if you want.
Oh, please do.
And I know this kind of goes back to the question we asked Kyle earlier, but I mean, obviously you surf primarily in Hawaii, you live in Hawaii and stuff like that. On wetsuits, obviously, you know, you're not on a regular basis, you're not wearing your prosthetics in the water. So on the wetsuits, when you go to colder places, like you're in La Jolla, I'm sure that was a lot more chilly than what you're used to. What are you wearing for a wetsuit in those conditions, and how are you keeping the lower part of your limbs warm?
I actually wear a protective, and it's shown in the picture here. Oh. It's a 2 millimeter sleeve that goes over my stumps and my knee.
Oh, okay.
So I'll wear that under a traditional wetsuit to keep water from coming up the leg. And I trim my wetsuits off by the knee, so I have a little better flexibility because I'm using my thumb with my foot. But I've found a traditional 3-2 or a 4 millimeter wetsuit, I actually need someone's help zipping me in. It's just to not having thumbs to pull the arms through. Get the shoulder in, and then all of a sudden I realized I don't have fingers to pull this thing.
Makes sense.
For help, I would sit there and struggle for 20 minutes, and then someone would go, can I help you? I go, yeah, sure.
Letting
help.
Yeah, I think, and Dennis was touching on this, I think a lot of people, and I get it. I mean, people are scared to ask someone if they need help, and then on the other side of the coin, on your side, you know, people also, you know, sometimes they're scared to ask someone else for help. And I think if you either on either end of it, you just ask in a genuine concern way on either side of that, someone's going to help, or you're going to get help. And to be above asking for help is just crazy. Like, I'll ask for help anytime I can get it. So.
But yeah, I do. I always ride with a 2 millimeter protective sleeve over my stumps and knees.
Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that. Even with your shorts on, you're wearing that.
Yeah.
How long is that board,
John? That one's an 8.8. That
single fin.
Yeah, Kazuma put a little pintail on the rear of it, but it's a traditional longboard nose.
Yeah.
So it's got a lot of stability paddling into stuff, but it has great performance on the wave.
So, I love it.
It looks like it.
It's like a cross between a big gun and a traditional longboard.
So I've got another question on your, let me go back to that picture. You know, that paddle on your right hand, I noticed you were talking with Liv down the Worlds, and I don't know if you used hers or not, or tried them, or what happened down there, but we have several above upper limb amputees and stuff that take part in our clinics all over the country. And I was just talking to this one guy, Jesse, the other day, who takes part on this coast. And is that a homemade design? Is there some place to buy those at? And how much effect does that have using those paddles?
It's this design actually, Liv ordered a couple sets off of Amazon. So I took one of those Amazon paddles, and then with the work of a prosthetist, we added Velcro straps.
Yeah.
So I actually Velcro that onto the arm. And nice. Now we're playing with different designs for the wing that can, so I can still pop up and paddle with it. But it can, it's fully adjustable with the Velcro.
Nice.
Yeah, and if people want to stay in touch with me, I've been got a few designs I'm working on. I've been happy to just hand out some of the extra prototypes or ones that I've used and have moved past to people to try. So I'm just happy to pass the gear along.
Cool, cool. Yeah, no, it's neat, and that's one thing I liked about, you know, at our clinics, but like especially at like events like Worlds and other contests where, you know, we've got so many people making so many different adaptations, everybody sharing that information, and it is such an amazing community, and nobody's like, oh no, I can't share this because this is how I'm going to win. Like everybody's just like, yeah, take my set, you know, like Liv sharing, you know, that's just awesome.
That awesome. Blue paddle in that picture is actually Liv's. She gave.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. At Worlds, and so that one's actually hers that I just adapted with Velcro.
Yeah, and just a programming note that anybody is wondering who Liv is. Liv Stone won gold at Worlds this year, and she will be on our virtual clinic on July 18th. So you'll get to meet her, and you can bombard her with questions as well. So yeah. Well, hey Josh, I wanted to say thank you so much for being on here with us and being a part of the call, and sharing all the information you've shared with us. And I just think that you're an amazing individual and a true inspiration to so many. Yes. And I just hope that you will continue to be a part of AmpSurf and obviously keep charging those waves and everything. So we're going to transition right now. Sorry, Josh, go ahead.
Oh, mahalo. No, thank you. Mahalo, yeah, brother. I love working with you guys in the future. Yeah, this is
you're very cool.
Program is changing lives.
Thanks, Josh.
Yeah. Aloha, Josh.
Good to see you.
So we are a couple minutes behind schedule as far as taking a break. So I apologize if anyone's been holding it so long. But if you need to run, totally get it. We're going to take about 3 minutes and take a break, and then we'll come back with Jacob Pacheco being interviewed by Jim Stitt. So take a break, folks. And again, thank you, Josh.
Yeah, and if you take your cameras in the bathroom with you, please mute the screen, the video.
I would appreciate everything be muted. I don't want to hear it either.
Good idea.
Oh, Lord. I'm trying to get another thing up of pictures for you guys. Sorry. That's a good picture right there with that rash guard on, Justin. That's perfect. We don't need any other pictures. There we go. All right. Now
I like that rash guard, Justin.
Those were the safety crew rash guards from Worlds, and we sent those out to all the chapters so that all the chapters would have those to have 1 to 2 key people on each beach be the designated safety people and easy to see and stuff like that. So,
yay.
Yeah, that'd be very good.
Rather than pink shirts.
Yeah, come on. I like that.
I like that pink shirt.
Yeah. Well, now you've got a pretty orange one to wear.
You should use those for the visually impaired surfers. So everybody can see where they are.
Yeah, that's another thing I want to do is our next rash guard order, I want to order up about, I don't know, probably 5 or 6 for each chapter that has big on the back, big on the front, blind surfer and stuff. Because I know like a lot of most all the contests, all the guys that are surfing in the blind divisions and the visually impaired division, that's what they wear so that people know. And that's what they wear when they're out and, you know, surfing on their own break. For instance, Shane Lopes here locally, you know, he's got a couple rash guards so that people know that he's blind and they don't, you know, get upset with him if he snakes them or something like that or makes him, you know.
Where's he been? I haven't seen him in a while.
He's been around. He's living down in Pismo, and he's surfing almost daily. I see him down there all the time. Yeah.
So it makes him an accessible kook?
Yeah, yes.
He is. Good kid. Very good kid.
Oh, I'm going to go on mute and listen to Dennis for a couple minutes.
Oh, tiny bubbles. Come on, give us tiny bubbles.
I love that Dennis is the music.
Makes me happy.
Dennis, do Over the Rainbow, baby. Thank you, my brother. That was awesome. Awesome, awesome. A round of applause for our man, even if it's a quiet one for the mute on. Hey, Dennis, great job.
Thank you.
I think you just made a whole lot of more friends, my brother. That was awesome.
I just needed one more besides you, David. Just one more.
Izzy's legacy lives through you, Dennis.
Oh, gosh, yeah. Hey, so up next, we are going to have Jacob Pacheco joined, being interviewed by Jim Stitt. And hey, there's Jacob for us right there. Jake, good to see you, my brother.
Hey, Jake.
Jim, why don't you go ahead and take it over, my friend?
All right. Hey, Jacob, thanks for showing up for the virtual clinic that we're having here.
Of course. Thank you for having me, man. Happy to be here.
It's great having you. First, I'm going to read a little bit of a bio about Jacob so everybody knows his background, and we'll proceed from there. Jacob was born with cerebral palsy, and he has successfully thrived despite his challenges. Throughout Jacob's life, he's faced incredible adversity, including bullying, medical setbacks, abuse, clinical depression, and even told he would not be incapable of walking after the age of 16. Despite this, Jacob turned disability into adversity into opportunity. Against the odds, Jacob has proven you can prevail and discover fulfillment despite challenges. Amen there. The result of commitment through adversity to discover your best and keep charging forward. Jacob brings his platform, Prone to Ride, through social media and YouTube to people and inspires others to keep charging forward towards their dreams and goals. And with that, Jacob, I'm going to ask you to tell us more about Prone to Ride.
That's a great question, and thank you for that wonderful introduction. I want to say thank you to AmpSurf, Dana, and all you people for joining us today for this beautiful talk. Love seeing my guys, Joshy, Kyle. Brett's presentation was fantastic, so I feel very honored to be here. But to start off, Prone to Ride really started in 2016 as a result of having to kind of flip the script and try something new. So 10 years prior to that, I had been studying in graduate school and my bachelor's to work in professional sports. I wanted to become a professional sport coach in the professional leagues like the NFL, MLS, or in the European soccer leagues. So I had been working up to that point in Division I professional sports. And I received a lot of discrimination and a lot of terrible derogatory comments towards my profession. I kind of put it all to the side and I kept working through it until finally I reached a point of no return where I had to decide what I wanted for my life because I had received some very terrible news where I was told face to face that I would not have the ability or experience to ever work with athletes at the collegiate level or professional level. So that was a real tough pill for me to swallow. And I didn't believe that, but I had to kind of bait and switch. I was like, am I going to keep trying to fight against this tide or this current, or am I going to switch bait and try to paddle around it and go for something else? And so I had a conversation, late night conversation with a buddy of mine who asked me the question, like, what do you really want to do with your life? Like, do you really need to be working for someone else? Do you really need to be kind of proving yourself to all these other people, or have you already proved to yourself that you're capable of more? And I was like, I am capable of more. And he was like, well, why don't you try to go surf? Why don't you try to make something out of that and empower other people to do what you do? And that's how Prone to Ride was born. Now I have a company that empowers others through life coaching, through social media, through YouTube, to really inspire people to go after their goals, but not only inspire, but to keep them motivated and sustain that success over the long term. Because I believe inspiration only lasts for about 5 seconds, but motivation is really the long-term kind of fuel to keep you going. And that's really important. Yeah. So that's really what Prone to Ride is all about.
Well, you have cerebral palsy, and how does that affect your body and how does that affect your surfing?
That's a great question. I would contemplate, or I would explain cerebral palsy as a guy who looks like he had too much to drink the night before every day of his life, but the only thing he had to drink was the elixir of life. It's fantastic.
Amen.
But a very simple explanation of what cerebral palsy is if you draw two set of points on a piece of paper, you draw a straight line across the first set of points. That's a normal functioning brain with all sorts of no coordination problems, no balance problems, and complete motor control. You draw a second set of lines and you draw a wavy line through those two set of points. And that's essentially what cerebral palsy is. It's brain damage on a neurological level. So it affects my motor control, my balance and coordination, And sometimes my mental function of how to keep a sentence straight, I'm just kidding, no, it doesn't. But it really affects my motor control and my ability to balance. So I can sometimes trip and fall, and it looks like I walk like a platypus a little bit. And how it affects my surfing is it really kind of works out my core muscles and my hip muscles and my quadriceps. So it's really from chest to knees and to feet that really kind of push my skill set a little bit. So I surf lying down. It's very difficult for me to stand up. Now, if I had a 20-foot board and like a person helping me stand up, that's a whole nother ballgame. But that's how I surf that. And I, as you can see there on those pictures, I'm sending it down the line on lots of good waves.
Yeah, you look like you're having fun.
Oh, always.
Yeah, big smile on your face. It looks like a short board. Is it different from a standard short board?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I've surfed a variety of boards throughout my time of surfing. I started with an 8-foot foam board that I bought for $100 that was like sandpaper on my chest. Fantastic. I definitely got some hair growing there now. So I started off with that, but I eventually grew to where I kind of got shorter and shorter and shorter. And now I surf a 5'5" board. That's very short. I believe it's the shortest board for prone surfing in the world that I know of. So, and I'm pretty sure I keep my ear to the ground as far as who's surfing what and where. So my current board that I use consistently is a 5'5" board. It's very small, but the speed is great. Pictures that you see there, I'm surfing a 7'4" gun. So I have a wide range of ability, but my consistent one is a short board because I'm a need for speed guy. I love going down the faces of the waves with so much speed that I'm like, oh my God.
Well, it looked but like you pearled great. It in that one shot.
Oh yeah, there's been plenty of those. Don't you worry about that.
Like we all do.
Yeah. Saltwater smoothie is what I got.
Hey, so you're an adaptive surfer. Do you think other people living with CP will benefit from surfing with organizations like AmpSurf?
Oh, absolutely. There's no question about it. There's lots of positivity in going into the water, as Brett mentioned earlier, as Kyle mentioned earlier, and Josh mentioned earlier. They all said the same things. It's a healing factor. And you also get an excellent, excellent workout, especially in the target areas of what your disability might be affected by. For me specifically, it's my abs and my hips and my knees and my quads. I tell you what, I feel like I went through a yoga session like we got put through this morning by wonderful Ashley, who relaxed us up a little bit. I feel like I went through a yoga session, a workout session, and an emotional session when I surf every time. So it's a fantastic tool to use for self-care. But I will say this, I get lots of DMs, lots of private messages from gung-ho people that always want to go out and try what we do. You know, Josh, Kyle, and everybody's like, oh, well, I can do that. And I appreciate the confidence. I appreciate the gusto to go get it. But I always tell people now to come correct, because there are people that make this a lifestyle and they work very, very hard at it. And a lot of people think they're going to step in and compete at a very high level. And I don't think that gives justice to the Josh, to Kyle, or I, who put in the work to really work hard and go through those extreme trials where we have no control over what happens to us out there, but we are able to maintain our cool and go for it, you know? So there's always there's a balance there that needs to be accepted.
Yeah. Well, that leads right into my next question, was that you grew up with a lot of adversity and, you know, people told you there are things you couldn't do, but what drove you to prove them wrong and focus on your abilities?
I think that's a great question. So I definitely started by trying to prove people wrong, and eventually it transformed into what can I do for myself? How can I live for myself and live life on my terms? And I think that's more important. A lot of people with congenital disabilities grow up thinking that they have to prove themselves and that they are totally like capable of doing things that people said they couldn't do. But the question I have for them is, what do you want for yourself? How do you want to live your life? what do you see for yourself as a happy life? And that's when they kind of take a step back and they're wondering, well, I don't have an answer for that. I'm like, well, maybe we could focus on that answer instead of trying to prove other people wrong. Because I could tell you, I could have a list of names that and things that people have said to me that are very hurtful, very painful, that and the abuse that I experienced about feeling weak and inadequate, but that's not a full reflection of human potential and capability. So what I did was I asked myself, what do I want from this life? What do I want to be? What do I want to do? What is my version of a gratitude of a life filled with gratitude and fulfillment? And I kept focusing on that. And I decided to listen to my heart, and regardless of what anybody told me, because when I started surfing and I wanted to go professional, you know, everybody was like, that's ridiculous. How can you make a living off that? How can you do this? How can you do that? You really need, you know, something to support you and all this other stuff. But I believed in myself, and I used all of the resources that I had at my disposal to work for me. And I think that's something that people with disabilities don't necessarily understand, is how many resources are available to you if you spend the time to look for them. Because I'll tell you what, people may see your life as difficult, but man, they sure do roll out the red carpet if they and they can help you a lot if they want to. So use it, yeah. Leverage it to work for you.
And you're definitely setting the standard, brother. You're rocking it.
I'm following in the footsteps of those that came before me. So yeah.
What other sports have you been involved with?
So I've competed in baseball, wrestling, track and field, football.
I was a wrestler.
And soccer. Yeah, wrestling was fun until I realized that I didn't like my face getting smashed into a mat a lot. Because I was very light and small, so, and everybody was always stronger than me. So I was like, I enjoyed it because I felt like I was proving something. But at the same time, I was like, man, you know, getting rug burn on your face doesn't look good.
Yeah, mat burn. Shots. Yep. Cauliflower ear. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. You know what's up.
I do. It was a great sport. Hey, you know what? I really thank you, Jacob, for joining us today on the, you know, on this virtual surf therapy event. Really appreciate it. And thank you for your insight and your inspiration. You are an inspiration, as all the other speakers have been today too. Thank you so much.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Hey, Jacob, thanks as well. Anyone have any questions they want to shoot at Jake?
Yeah, let's ask some questions, guys. We haven't had too many questions. I want to hear somebody get out there. Ask us whatever you want, you know.
What weight did you wrestle? What weight class did you wrestle?
I was below.
180s.
Yeah, right. So I don't even look 180. Oh, man.
Wet. Well, when I,
with the board.
With the board, plus an extra 30-pound weight on my side. No, I wrestled in eighth grade at 77 pounds. And when I finished wrestling, I was 97 pounds. So I was always very light, very small.
Cool.
But you had a good time. Question.
Yeah, let's hear it.
I have a few friends with cerebral palsy, and I know some of them mentioned sometimes they have like a delay when they're thinking, they get like a short delay. Do you ever experience that while you're surfing?
No, that the beauty of cerebral palsy is that it has a wide range of effects, and it varies between person to person. So it can affect cognitive function for some, but for others it doesn't. So it's a crazy, crazy condition, but it's kind of beautiful in that it creates all sorts of different colors and varieties between us. It's one of the most common disabilities in the world.
Wow.
True. Now, I was just wondering, because I'm visually impaired, but I always have a delay between when I see something and when I mentally realize what I'm seeing. So that's why I was hoping you had that delay so you could give me a tip.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, here's what I could tell you is try to take a deep breath and try to look beyond what the waves are actually doing. So I know Brett mentioned this earlier where he was like, you know, you might get hit by some white water. You might be focused on what's in front of you. And I kind of wanted to make a joke. Well, I'm looking at what's in front of me, but I'm also trying to look at what's behind that, because I know what's coming after that big wave is usually another one. That's the beauty of a set. So what I would say is if you're having difficulty difficulties with your cognitive function, I would try to say take a deep breath, take a step back, or to kind of gather yourself, especially in water. One of the best tips I ever heard from a surf coach was, you have time out there. Even if another wave's coming, you can settle yourself. And if you get hit by another wave, it's fine, because you're going to just get pushed back in and it's going to calm you down a little bit. It's always going to calm down the further, closer to shore you go. So if you have to reset and go back out, that's what you do. And that's what I've done multiple times. So gather your thoughts, gather your feelings, take a look around, survey your surroundings, and find a way to get yourself out of that situation.
Thank you.
Hey,
yeah, no problem. Hey,
Jacob, a question from the chat. How old were you when you started surfing?
26. I have been surfing now since, oh, I'm sorry, no, I started when I was 24. I'm 30 now, so I've been surfing for 6 years.
Very cool.
Yeah. And Josh, you're a legend too, my man. You're a legend too.
A question I had, because I saw, I think it's in your bio and also on Facebook, that you do some work with LA Galaxy as a coach or cap something. Could you just tell me about that a little bit?
Yeah, so I worked with the LA Galaxy for 2.5 years. I was on television with them a couple times. And we also brought, we also connected the adaptive community to the LA Galaxy with my ability to talk to different organizations and work it out. So I had the ability to work for them for a couple of years. I don't work for them anymore, but I was able to wear the shirt, wear the logo, and be a representative for their organization at various events as a coach, and also as an athlete too. So that was pretty cool.
Very cool.
Yeah, yeah. We have a question here. What are some modifications you made to your equipment to make them more functional for you? That's a great question. So I have a sponsorship from a surf equipment company called Surf Knobs. And Surf Knobs is kind of like yoga blocks on a surfboard. They're meant to help you with your pop-up, but I use them as handles. They're much safer than a normal handle on a surfboard, which is can be wrapped in neoprene, but if it hits you, it can really hurt. And when the Surf Knobs hit you, they're just basically all cushion. So when they really hit you, you don't really feel anything at all. So those are some of the modifications I use. But mainly, the main modification I use is in the complete shape of the board. My sponsors and my shapers have always kind of pushed me to get outside of my comfort zone. So they'll give me model boards that are not technically very good for adaptive use, but they're like, figure it out. And I think that's a motto for my life, is a lot of people and a lot of how I've functioned is just about living, figuring it out. They'll throw me a board and say, figure it out. And I'll be like, sure, whatever, I'll figure it out, you know? And so the modifications that I do use is concave in the bottom. So I create that V that allows me to really kind of set my rail when I go down the line. And also scooping out the center of the board to create kind of like a bucket, a small bucket. And it helps me to engage my obliques and my abdomen when I go left or right. So if I can feel that tension on my midriff, I'm able to tell my muscles and my legs and my hips to engage and push back. Having that centrifugal force helps me kind of balance it out. And so scooping the middle portion of the board out helps me kind of stay centered, feel it a little bit deeper, and to engage my muscles a little bit better and get a more complete workout. I surf at least 2 to 3 times a week, an hour to an hour and a half. If it goes really well, I'll go 2, 2.5. But usually my sweet spot is an hour, hour 15 minutes. You have an older sister with cerebral palsy. But it's usually...
Yeah, Jake, basically, how would you encourage others that might be worried about being embarrassed to get out there and try new stuff?
I would say you need to accept that it's going to happen. We're going to look ridiculous. We're going to fall. So I'll even share a personal story right now. I was on a date with my girlfriend recently, and I fell backwards down the stairs in a movie theater onto her. It's very traumatic, very, very vulnerable. It's a very vulnerable moment. I felt weak. I felt vulnerable, but I had to accept that that's my life. This is part of who I am and what I do. And it's going to happen. I'm going to fall. It's just part of my life. But I restructured my mindset to really feel like, well, this is a moment for her to see if she can really hang, you know? So it's like, can she handle it? You know, can she handle it? But she did, and I handled it well too. Sure, I was in a lot of pain, but it's just part of life. And the people that support you, that love you, are going to accept that for what it is. And if they can accept it, so can you. So I would say just be happy with what you have. Be happy with what happens out there. Like, the fact that you're putting yourself out there and going for it and doing it, you're already ahead of 99% of everybody else who's around you, because they're looking to you to make that action, to take that action. And yeah, and that's what I would say. And we're all going to look like kooks out there, so you might as well live it up.
Hey, Jacob, thank you so much for sharing with us today and being on today's Zoom with everybody. And Jim, thank you for doing the interview. All phenomenal job, and keep on inspiring people, keep on promoting adaptive athletes to keep charging and getting more people in the water and out just living life, regardless of whether it's a water sport or any other sport. We always want to encourage people to focus on their abilities, and you do that in an amazing way. So thank you for everything. So coming up next, we're going to have our How Not to Be a Kook piece of the programming. And so this kind of falls really in line with last week's thing on surf etiquette. A lot of the same principles and stuff like that. And the reason why we're kind of doing this like this is because this is some important stuff. The surf etiquette and everything means a lot. And we want to make sure that when we go out to whatever beaches we're at, we're being respectful and all that good stuff. So I'm going to take this spotlight off of you, Jacob. And again, thank you so much. Any final words before I kick you to the curb here, brother?
Oh, well, geez, Dana. No, I'm just kidding. I just want to say,
we thank know you. Each other, by the way, everybody, we know each other very well. So we
can... Yeah. I've known Dana for a long time. And I have to say, I love how far AmpSurf's come and put in a lot of work, and it's fantastic to see. And I love the fact that you've created this crew now that comes out and enjoys the water with us. And I have to say, like, every time I'm around your staff and you, it's always so enlightening and empowering, and everybody's having a good time. And I just want to say thank you so much to the AmpSurf community for letting us be a part of your family today. And I always feel so much love and gratitude here. And thank you for letting us be a part of it.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. All right. Without further ado, I'm going to change the spotlight over to Melissa. I see she's ready to go in her gym, and she's going to lead our Kook convo. So Melissa, just really quickly before you start, I'd just like you to take 2 minutes and just talk about your program that you've developed for adaptive athletes and getting them working out. So 2 minute promo.
All right. Well, thank you. I am so honored and excited to be here. AmpSurf has been a huge part of my journey of kind of tapping back into that inner athlete within myself. My name is Melissa DeCellis. I'm sitting here. I will be finishing my personal training certification at the American Academy of Personal Training. So I will not only be an adaptive trainer, but an able-bodied trainer as well in 2 short weeks. So I'm really excited about that. I am the founder and the president of a nonprofit 501(c) called Adaptively Abled Amputees. When I lost my leg, I had a traumatic softball, sliding injury, multiple reconstructions, eventually decided that an elective below the knee amputation was the way to go. And it actually gave me my mobility and my life back. I called that my reset. And from that point on, I've been able to kind of redefine who I am and what's important in life, and decided that when I was about 33, when I lost my leg, and it was very socially isolating. There were a lot of people that I thought were pivotal in my life, and they were not there when I lost my leg. It was really depressing and really socially isolating. So I vowed that when I got back on 2 feet, that I wanted to start an organization that would provide support, activities, events, and social events for people to be able to get out there and communicate and interact with other people who understood what they were going through. So we first started out as a social meetup group, and we had coffee chats. We had cookouts, holiday parties. Then we started to become a little bit more active. We go canoeing, kayaking, surfing, rock climbing, bowling, you name it, we've probably done it. We've built the group over the last 3 years. We officially launched as an official nonprofit last summer, adaptively abled amputees, and we expanded our mission statement. So we are a social support and activity group for anybody living with a physical disability. And as COVID hit, we decided to take most of our programming virtually. So we offer virtual programming for most days of the week. We have a coffee house, we have a support group, we have a social hour. We are ready to launch an outdoor adaptive workout on Monday evenings in the Boston area. If you're interested, please reach out to me. I will put my information in the chat box. And part of the nonprofit, I was very fortunate that I was sponsored to go down and train at a gym in Dallas, Texas called the Adaptive Training Foundation. It's a gym that only trains adaptive athletes. It was an extremely life-changing experience for me. And when I came home to Boston, I wanted to bring a little bit of what I learned down in Texas home to my own community. So this past September, we launched a program called Adaptively Abled Fitness. It was Boston's first adaptive functional fitness and holistic health program. I was able to recruit top physical medicine and physiatry physicians. We had physical therapists, occupational therapists. We had personal trainers, strength and conditioning coaches. Most of the programming and the planning committee was all run by adaptive athletes. We had peer trainers, so adaptive athletes themselves that wanted to give back to the next generation of adaptive athletes. We also incorporated a wellness piece. So we incorporated nutrition and education. We taught people about active recovery and how to foam roll, supplements and things that could help their performance and their overall recovery. We also incorporated mindset meditation. We had yoga sessions, and we started out each session with a little bit of mindfulness meditation and some basic yoga, stretching, and flow movements. And it was one of Boston's first comprehensive programs. We are getting ready to move our program outdoor, given the given restrictions. And we'll be starting on July 6th, Mondays from 6 to 7:30 at the Charlestown Community Center. It's a big, large turf. We have plenty of room to be able to safely social distance, and I'm really excited to be able to offer this for the community. In addition, I also coach and help program for a virtual adaptive fitness program that we run on Wednesdays during a lunch hour. So it's 12 to 1 Eastern time, and anybody's welcome to log on. Again, contact me if you're interested in any of these programs. And I'm really excited to be able to bring on my co-host of a new podcast that James Norris and I created. So James Norris is the founder of Handicapable Fitness, and we've become very good friends over the past year or so. And what we realize is that there's a lot of adaptive groups out there, but there's not a lot of collaboration. So the goals of our new podcast called the Adaptive Collaborative are to be able to connect professionals, athletes, companies, all within the adaptive space. So we're hoping to promote a healthy and inclusive lifestyle brand.
Awesome, Melissa. Thank you so much for sharing all that. Melissa, hey, thanks for sharing all that. Anybody's wondering, Melissa's got a lot of information, obviously, and we want to hear more about it. So she's actually going to be one of our guest speakers coming up in July. And so we're going to hear a lot more about the program, Adaptively Able Amputees, and James' program and stuff like that. But Melissa, we're going to, we need to switch over to the not being a kook. And so if you can go ahead and start that, we did not create a slideshow for this one. So we're just going to use this awesome image for everyone to share and love. And sometimes I think I look like this guy on the beach. So Melissa, go ahead and introduce your team and hit it.
Right. So again, my name is Melissa DeChellis, and I'm here with my very good friend and buddy, James Norris, and with AmpSurf instructor legend, Marcel Picant. James and I are adaptive athletes that want to become surfers. So we're going to spend the next 15 minutes asking Marcel important questions about how not to be a kook. So Marcel, why don't you start off by telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, appreciate the legend comment. I don't think I'm a legend, but made my Saturday.
We think you are.
Thank you.
Yes.
So yeah, I've been surfing about 25 years. I'm based in Boston. Grew up in Florida. Began surfing Central Florida, if you know Cocoa Beach and Satellite Beach area, and made my way up to the north about 8 years ago. Surfed from Maine to Rhode Island. And through all that time, I cooped it up multiple times. I've learned a lot. There's, you know, in the water, different personalities, different vibes, different animal life. But not being a kook is like a universal thing. It applies to every beach on the planet. So yeah, just happy to share some kook wisdom and kook experiences.
Marcel, thank you again for joining us and giving us a little bit of that background. But why don't you start off by telling people what is a kook and are all beginners kooks?
Yeah, so it's kind of a common misperception. All beginners are not kooks. You don't just start surfing like, now I'm a kook. Kook is basically someone that's kind of not comprehending or lacking the understanding of social norms and etiquette and just surfer culture in general. This applies out of the water, but in the water specifically, it kind of creates unsafe environments. Safety is a big, safety is paramount in surfing. So being a kook in the water and not kind of understanding etiquette and not following it definitely provides creates some issues in the water.
So that makes so much sense. Sean O'Brien hosted a panel on surf etiquette at the virtual clinic last week. It is available on the AmpSurf YouTube channel if anybody would like to go and review it. So Marcel, in your opinion, what is the most important key to not being a kook?
Practice. Practice makes perfect. Same thing applies in surfing. Surf as much as you possibly can. Be at the beach as much as you possibly can, be in the water. Surfing is a pretty high learning curve. There's a lot of things going on. Just being comfortable in the water moving, knowing how to swim, being on your board, balancing, all that kind of stuff just plays a huge role. So just being comfortable in the water. Having a battle buddy, what Sarah Betancourt from Team USA mentioned, I think in the first virtual clinic, perfect concept. This is somebody who might be not necessarily surfing, but who's there for support, for safety, for camaraderie, for motivation. They're just there with you, taking pictures. More importantly, everyone wants to get their picture taken while you're surfing, so you need that person. But yeah, just you want to bring somebody to help you get out there and get yourself a little bit uncomfortable. And also really quick, just going to the beach and maybe not even surfing, but just like watch, go to your local break. Look at the ocean, look at the folks surfing, take one or two women or a guy and just follow them for 15 minutes and just see what they're doing. You learn a lot that way.
That makes a whole lot of sense.
Thanks.
So James, you want to be my battle buddy?
Let's do it.
All right. So Marcel, what else do we need to know about not being a kook?
Yeah, there's a couple things, I guess. So kind of more for the safety aspect of things, don't ditch your board. So this is kind of a very cardinal sin, very dangerous thing to do, but it's very natural sometimes. When you're out there in the water, there's a lot of other people usually with you or behind you, specifically ditching your board just leads to the problem. So being comfortable in the water, being able to grab your board, however, through a wave, if you have to get off your board and just grab it with your arms, do that. But, recklessly kind of throwing your board back and diving under the water just creates problems. And also a very big cardinal sin is don't drop in on somebody on the wave. What this kind of means is I'm a regular surfer. So if I'm on a wave or trying to get to a wave, I want to go right usually. I'm always going to be looking at my left side to see if there's someone already on the wave. That person would have the longest ride. They're at the closest area to the peak. They have priority, regardless. Doesn't matter who they are, they're priority. So I'm backing off that wave, and they're going to go, right to my right. Just knowing that is a big deal. I think the drop in experience wise is like, it's the only time I think you'll be confronted. And if you do that, you know, things definitely happen. So, you know, things are moving fast in the water, owning up to your mistake, and kind of talking to that later on. But it happens, but just try to avoid that at all costs.
That seems kind of complicated. And a lot of hysteria leading into the line. Am I right about that?
Yeah, so there's definitely a hierarchy in the water. And it plays a big part in not being a kook. So, you know, the honor in the lineup is just, you know, the lineup is the gathering of people in the water at a specific area. You're the new person, right? So I think Kyle kind of touched on it earlier. You go to your local break, you're going to see the same people all the time. They're the same guys and girls out there surfing. You are now the new person, the foreigner. So, you know, you're going to start from the bottom. And this is like, this is not going to be California, Hawaii, where everything's agro and things like that. But in New England, it's very calm up here for the most part. But you're still a new person. You kind of ease in. You take a wave when you have it, but you're not just taking every single wave. So that's kind of honoring the lineup. You're honoring people who are already there. There's a pecking order that's kind of established, because if not, it actually would be kind of chaotic. And it's just kind of a natural order of things. On that same thought, you get respect to give respect to gain respect. The easiest way is, you know, they don't have anything to prove. The locals, the friends of the locals, everyone at that break doesn't really have anything to prove. You have more to prove to them. Kind of a raw way of saying it, but you kind of, you know, you give respect to get respect. You know, follow these guidelines, I guess you could say, and you are given that respect in that manner. But you just kind of have to be aware of the pecking order.
Oh, that sounds like a lot of rules. What do you do if you mess up?
What if you mess up? Well, you just can't surf anymore. That's it. One time, that's it. Own up to your mistakes. I mean, this is kind of life-based things. You know, New England, we're always wearing a wetsuit for the most part. So sometimes where I make those mistakes, you can't really hear anything. It's hard to talk through a wetsuit. You can't hear anyways because it's just, you know, wavelengths and whatever. But I kind of like, hey, my bad. As soon as I can safely look at the person that I made a mistake on, I just kind of give them a little heartbeat, like, yep, I did that, my fault, won't do it again. Most of the time, people are like, oh, it's fine, whatever. Most of the time, it's kind of like, you're going to get ignored. They'll see it, but they ignore, you agitated them, whatever. I think rarely you'll ever get, like, confronted with things, but owning up to your mistake, I think immediately kind of dissolves any issue. Obviously, you don't want to do it again either, but. Oh, and sorry, and then on the same note, knowing your limits. This actually applies to like beginners, to advanced, to everything. When you're beginning, obviously you want to go to probably a less crowded spot. You want to get used to your board, be comfortable in the water. Maybe whatever your disability is, just getting used to that aspect of things. But it also, like, if you have a bad day or I'm hungover, maybe, you know, I don't want to go out all the way outside. Maybe my back is hurting that day. Like, just knowing your limits, your mindset's one thing, but when you're out in the water, things get a little hairy pretty fast.
I know Melissa will be out there cooking it up. Does that make me a kook too, just because I came to the beach with her?
Yeah, it does. Kook is contagious. Not so much contagious, yes. So if you do a kook thing and you're with a group of people or a person and you paddle over to that person, the other folks that saw that kook behavior, you are also the kook. So I didn't make the rules, but that's just the way it goes. Just try to avoid not being kook, I guess. you know, kind of on the lines of this is, you know, be aware and be decisive. Being aware is kind of, I think, the ultimate, like, how it nets all these kook etiquette things together. Know, like, know where people, where the other surfers are out in the water, understand where the breaks sat in the water, where the danger zone, maybe there's rocks or something like that. Just being aware and seeing, you know, there's this one guy or two girls over there that keep going right, and they're there, so you know they're going to be in your way at some point, or you're going to be in their way at some point. So just being aware. And then also being decisive in the fact of, like, what you're doing out there. People are taking note, as, like, you're taking note of others. So if you're going to get a wave and you've made sure that that wave is yours, it's clear, take the wave. Paddle, and take it. If you make it, doesn't matter, but, like, just taking that wave and being decisive with that. People are out in the water trying to predict what other people are doing. So, you know, if you're indecisive multiple times, people, they're not going to really trust and know what you're going to do and not to know what to expect from you. And you might get snaked or it'd just be helpful to just be decisive in whatever you do. Especially, sorry, I'm long-winded here, but if you're paddling out and someone's catching a wave and you see them, instead of being like a deer in headlights, paddle straight or paddle, you know, some way out of their way. It's usually not towards them, but going in one direction, let them kind of make the maneuver around you. It's, again, the predictability of things. They're looking at you. They're looking at everything. Everything's happening like split seconds. So you being predictable will allow them to do whatever they need to do.
That's a ton of great information. Well, we're just about out of time. So, Marcel, did we miss anything?
Yes. Yep. The 10th rule is have fun. Best surf in the water is the one having the most fun. The golden rule. So, I mean, you follow, you know, some surf etiquette when you go, wherever you go, you will have fun. People around you are going to have fun. That's the whole name of the game in surfing. It's therapeutic, yes. It's all these things. It's great for your body, but we're just having fun.
So if you're interested in checking it out, the 10 Surf Commandments was adopted by a GQ article by Ben Sobel titled Don't Be a Kook, the GQ Guide to Surf Etiquette, published in July of 2013. It goes into more detail and is definitely worth checking out. I really want to thank my battle buddies, James and Marcel, for shedding a little light on how not to be a kook.
Thank you so much.
I am still muted, sorry. Hey, thanks everybody. Marcel, Melissa, James, great job. Does anybody have any questions they wanna throw at these guys before we transition off of this subject?
I have one question for Marcel. So I have a question about ditching the board. So in an adaptive surfer case, specifically a prone surfer, sometimes, I know I struggle with duck diving and turtle rolling, and every time I've gone through big surf, like 6 to 7, maybe 9 foot waves, every time I try to turtle roll or duck dive or do something like that and not ditch my board, I've always gotten hit by my board pretty aggressively. And I'm not gonna lie to you, it knocks the wind out of me and it makes me see stars. So I know it's not right to do, but what would you suggest for people that maybe don't have the option of not ditching the board? You know, like they may have to do it. What's an alternative for them?
Yeah, great question. So, I mean, I think kind of being aware, you know, one of the rules here, when you're paddling out, and I'm assuming, you know, this is kind of a paddle out question, give yourself some space. You see some people paddling out, maybe give yourself 20 yards, paddle out to the left of them. You might do some paddling later on, but there are definitely instances where you have to bail on your board. I've done it like a lot of times. Knowing that there's no one behind you, like it's just like a stress or a eliminates.
It's like
stress.
A missile. It's like a missile.
Yeah. Yes. The board's come fast. But knowing there's no one behind you, it basically just kind of, it alleviates the fact that you need to bail. you're not going to put anybody in danger. If it's the case where you're out there and now, you know, people are behind you, I don't know. Like,
Hold on. Like, I would still hold on if someone was behind me. But I know that, because I've been asked that question before as well about ditching the board, and I know it's a no-go. But the people, like, for example, I have some friends who are adaptive surfers who are learning, and they're like, I don't want to get hit by the wave. But you do, I know that there's a point where you grow, right? Where you don't feel like you can make it over the wave, but you actually do. So would you suggest people to just keep paddling until the absolute last moment where you know for sure?
Yeah, I mean, I think with practice, you're going to get better. You're going to understand what to do with your board better, depending on what board you're using. You're going to understand better, like, what should I do with this board? I guess I could throw it back to practice. Things do happen, though. Like, I fell on a board probably every session, at least one time, for whatever reason. Just looking behind you, I guess, and maybe being aware. I guess I'm kind of fumbling the answer a little bit just because, like, it does happen. So just knowing that there's no one behind you, you're not going to, you know, risk anything.
Yeah, I got you. That was just a question I had. I wanted to see what you thought about it.
Yeah. Thanks.
All right. Well, hey, guys, thank you so much for doing that period of instruction for us. We've got more clinics coming up here in the future. So hopefully we can learn some more great stuff from everyone that's out there. I just wanted to say a quick first off, I need to do a drawing for swag. So I apologize for potentially missing that. But everyone that's on this call this week, you'll be in a drawing at the next event for some swag. And so I'm going to quickly, all I have is a spreadsheet up here on my screen. And so I'm just going to blindly point my finger, see who wins. And so I've got Posey. I don't know if Posey's still on or not, but Posey, you just won some swag besides anything else you may have already gotten. So Posey, thank you for being on the last one. Is Posey still on? Posey, feel free to unmute if you are. So she's a winner today. She'll get an AmpSurf sweatshirt from us. So Posey, great job. Thank you so much. And I think I have.
She's not. She had to leave.
Oh, she did. Okay. We'll let her know that she's the winner. And Posey, thanks for being a part of our group. As always, you're a phenomenal human being, and we love you. And then news, I want to just share with everybody some stuff that's going on with AmpSurf and everything we're doing. I'm going to take the spotlight off of Jacob here so we can see everybody. I hope it works. Is everybody still seeing Jacob?
Nope. Got your mug.
Okay, we got full view of everybody now, though.
We got you and Dennis.
I'm not sure why I've got everybody up on my
screen. I got gallery. Yeah, I got gallery.
Gallery button at the top, it should come up. And I apologize if it doesn't. But anyway, so here, let me share some news with you guys. So we've got really great stuff. One, first and foremost, I want to share that we've got some new board members and new members of our advisory board. Some are on this call with us right now. And some had to leave. Brett is one, but he had to take off. But we just want to say thank you, Brett, for joining our team as an advisor. Also, Matt Wolf out of New York's joined our board of directors. Norm Stanton from New England area in Vermont is joining our advisory board. Valerie, who was on here earlier, had to leave. She's joining our board of directors and will be up in our Pacific Northwest chapter. And then Raquel is joining us from Mexico and on our advisory board. And she'll be helping us as we launch to do more stuff internationally. And then we have Melissa Cummings, who happens to be my first cousin once removed, I think is a proper title. She's joining our advisory board. She's a PT, and so we're excited to have her as part of the advisory board. And then a lot of you from New England know Justin Lepore. Actually, a lot of you know him from the West Coast as well. He came out to the Summer Sports Clinic. He's joining our advisory board. And last but not least is Ann McGowan, New York, who's also a therapist, I believe PT, and is joining our advisory board. So I just want to say a huge welcome to them as part of this event, and we'll be doing an official press release and all that jazz in the next week, announcing those folks coming on board and to help us and to help us grow and to provide the, you know, the best service that we can to all those that we serve. That's what it's all about, is making sure that everybody's safe and having a great time. And these people will definitely help us to make that happen. Next thing I wanted to announce is our upcoming virtual clinics in July. We have several. We have our Rockaway Warriors Weekend, which is going virtual. Everyone's invited to that. It will have a veteran-centric focus, but obviously anyone and everyone's invited to that. We've got some great speakers lined up. Adaptive surfer and winner of his division at the U.S. Open and Army veteran Tommy Cunahan, the fourth, will be on there. Charles Chaka Webb, who is the founder of Stoked for Life and the organizer of the U.S. Open, will be on, and also one of our participants and adaptive surfers, Jason Wheeler, will be featured as on July 10th. And then on July 11th, we have U.S. Adaptive Surf Team member and blind surfer Josh Loyola will be joining us. And then also U.S. team member and adaptive surfer Christy Gardner will be joining us, who's from my home state of Maine. And she's also one of my team members on USA Team USA. And she started surfing with AmpSurf. So that'll be great to have her on. And then you just heard from Melissa as that last session. She'll also be one of our guest speakers on, and she'll be sharing more about her program. And we'll have some questions lined up to ask her of how we can all get involved and do that, how actually we're developing a program together. So that'll be great. And then on the 18th, we have adaptive champion surfer Jose Martinez, who is also a veteran and on Team USA, and Quinn Watley, who's another adaptive Team USA member. And so all of them will be on. And that's very Team USA centric in July. It is our month of independence and all that good stuff. So, but that just happens to be a coincidence. So these folks are people that stepped up to help out with these and to be part of it. We're stoked to have them. And then we've got a couple more slots open in late July for the 25th. And we've got people on the line that are just figuring out their schedules, but Greg Cruz, who is the head of USA Surfing for adaptive and non-adaptive and is on the U.S. Paralympic Committee, U.S. Olympic Committee, will be joining us along with hopefully a few other key speakers from around the world. So I don't have them locked in yet, so I don't want to say who they are yet, but hopefully they'll be
Liv Stone too, right?
Join us. And I've just asked you to please invite your friends to be a part of these. We want to see these grow. We want to reach more people. And I just ask everyone to invite one friend to join you. You know, that would double the people that are on here with us. And so hopefully we can fill these puppies up. Last but definitely not least, hold on, Tommy. The more exciting thing I want to announce is that we are coming back to the beaches. It is actually happening. So we have approval right now to hit the beaches in Oregon at the end of July. So we will be doing an Oregon Pacific Northwest chapter clinic in July 25th and 26th up at Bassendorf Beach. So again, that official release will come out next week as well, but we've been working with the state up there and how we're going to do it. And so we've got all that stuff worked out. It will be a different event. It will not be the typical clinics where we're high-fiving all the time and lots of hugs and everybody gathering on the beach. It'll be a much more, it'll be a social distance type event. So we've developed some policies and procedures with the International Surf Therapy Organization. And they're up on our website. If you just go to the homepage at ampsurf.org, the second image on the page, you'll see the COVID-19 image. If you click on that, that'll take you to a link to all of our policies and procedures. And basically how these will work is that instead of having a big group meet at the beach on one day with pop-ups everywhere and everything else. We'll have just be meeting at the trailer. Each day we'll have no more than 20 people a day. We'll have three participants, three instructors, and three, We'll have each day we'll have no more than 18 people broken up into two groups of nine. And each one of those groups will have three instructors, three volunteers, and three participants. And they will be separated on the beach, and they will work together in those small groups. And then we will come back together while maintaining our social distance and finish up the event each day. Same timelines and everything else as the normal clinics that we've had in the past. Excuse me, Tom, I need you to be quiet, babe. Thanks. Sorry, guys. Anyway, it should be really good. Really looking forward to it. We're coming up with a more enhanced questionnaire for when people sign up. So you will have more check boxes to check on the sign up. So apologize for that. But we have to implement some different things as far as the COVID-19 stuff goes. At the events, when people show up, we will be doing temperature checks. We will be wearing the PPE. And doing everything we can to ensure that everybody stays safe and stays healthy. The last thing we would ever want to do is to cause someone that came to one of our events to get ill, whether it's from COVID-19 or anything else. So we want to really, you know, make sure we do this right. And we're hoping that, you know, if this all goes well, end of July up in Oregon, this can be a model for not only our clinics, but for our multitude of colleagues and partners around the world that are trying to get people back in the water. I think being in the water and surfing is just as important as a medicine and therapy, whatever you want to call it, as anything else. And so we want to make sure we're making we can do that and do it in a successful and safe manner. Okay, I'm out of gas on that. So anybody else got any further comments? Please unmute. Chime in, say hi, say bye, say whatever you want to do. We're pretty much wrapping this up, and I would love to hear from you.
Hey, nice job, quick Dana. Just a quick plug, Dana.
Sure.
Ben Ipa in Hawaii needs everybody's help. He's a legendary shaper, surfer. He is auctioning off a lot of his personal items to help pay for his medical condition, and it's not looking good for him, but they need help. I don't know if the auction is still open, but a lot of his personal boards, legendary boards, he's auctioning off to help with his medical payments. So if you happen to look up Ben Ipa, see what you guys can do, help him. He has helped millions of people worldwide with his shaping and his teachings. So anyway, I just wanted to throw that out there. Ben Ipa could use your help if you are looking for some good quality custom boards that he's owned, surfed, bought, and collected. He's got a lot out there. So anyway, I just wanted to throw that
info. Thanks, Dennis.
You betcha.
Dennis, can you put that information, or Doug, can we put that information on the our Facebook page or something, our website? That'd be possible.
Yeah, great. Yeah, why don't you get Dennis after and get that information from him? You can pump it up there for us. Doug's on here.
He's got stage 4 dementia, and it's not looking good. He just needs your help.
He's a great guy. I got to surf with him back in 2009 at Duke's Fest.
All righty, man. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. All right, everybody. Hey, anybody else, anything else to share? We'll conclude with a little music from my boy, Dennis. Thank you, my brother.
On the island.
Thanks again, Dana.
See you next time. Thank you, guys. Be well.
You too.
From the mountain to the ocean.
Hasta.
Hey, there's Johnny in the flesh.
On the island. We do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side. Mama's in the kitchen cooking dinner real nice. Beef stew on the stove, only salmon on ice. Weed and drink and you sing all day. Cully cuppy lie in the Hawaiian way. On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side. On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side. Mama's in the, yeah, we go grandma's house on the weekend clean yard. Cause if we don't go, grandma got a card. You know, I love my grandma every minute, every hour. On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side. On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side.
All righty, everybody, I love you. We'll get this one down better for you next time.
Hey, brother, thank you so much. That was awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome.
Hey, everybody. Peace, aloha. Love you, bro. Stay healthy and happy, everybody. We'll see you guys soon.
Thanks a lot, guys.
All right, be well, everyone. Thank you so much for being a part of this with us.
Yes. Oh,